Welcome to Just a Minute. Hello, my name is Nicholas Parsons, and as the minute waltz fades away, once more it is my pleasure to welcome the four diverse, outstanding, and experienced players of Just a Minute who are going to partake today. We welcome back Paul Merton, and he's joined by three of our other regular players, Derek, Nimmo, Peter Jones, and Clement Freud. Would you please welcome all four of them? And this particular edition of Just a Minute is coming from the Pleasance on the Edinburgh Fringe. Beside me sits Elaine Wigley, who's going to keep the score, and she will blow a whistle, which will tell us that 60 seconds are up, and whoever is speaking then will get an extra point. And I'm going to ask, as usual, our four players of the game to speak, if they can, on the subject that I give them, and as usual, they will try and do that without hesitation, without repetition, and without deviating from the subject on the card. Let us begin the show this week with Paul Merton. And Paul, the subject here is the Highlands. A good Scottish subject to begin this Scottish edition of Just a Minute. You have 60 seconds as usual, starting now.
I only learnt to drive a year ago, so the many times I've been up to Edinburgh in the past, I've not been able to take the car further on and explore some of the beautiful countryside, which I've seen in various films, such as the 39 Steps, where Richard Hannay jumps off the fourth bridge and then goes running through the Highlands and goes round to John Laurie's cottage, and there's Dame Peggy Ashcroft. Well, his wife there, and she gives him a coat, and he slips around the police, and then he finds a man with a missing finger, which is not as common as you might think, actually. And he got the bit that was missing was the bottom bit, the top bit was still there.
Clement Freud, you challenged.
Two missings.
Two missings, yes. So, Clement, you have a correct challenge, and you get a point for that. You take over the subject of the Highlands, and there are 26 seconds available starting now.
I'm never quite sure where the Highlands begin.
Derek Nimmo, challenge.
I am. Stirling is the gateway to the Highlands.
I was told Loch Lomond was, but doesn't really matter.
Stirling.
But I don't think you get any points for showing off, Derek. What do you mean, oh, he doesn't say? It's not one of the rules of Just a Minute. So Clement was interrupted. He gets a point for that. 23 seconds are still available, Clement. The Highlands starting now.
There is, I'm told, considerable discussion whether the Highlands start at Stirling or Loch Lomond. And I personally...
Paul Merton, new challenge.
Repetition of start.
Beginning before.
No, beginning before.
Oh.
Yes. Well tried, Paul. Yes. 15 seconds are still available on the Highlands. Still with you, Clement, starting now.
The Highlands and Islands are particularly famous for the malt whisky, which is wholly excellent. Perhaps Islay is where the profusion of this liquor comes from. Berwick Laddie, Port Ellen, Port Charlotte.
Whoever is speaking, as the whistle goes, gains an extra point. It was on this occasion Clement Freud. In fact, he's the only one to have scored any points in that round. To negate those letters I sometimes get, and they say, why didn't you correct him? It wasn't Peggy Ashcroft in the film of John Hannay. It was Madeline Carroll.
Yeah, but she played the blonde one. The wife of John Laurie was Dame Peggy Ashcroft.
Oh, that's very interesting. I thought you were referring to the girl who fell in love with Richard Hannay. So anyway, we've got that quite clear for those who like to make their historical and cinematographic notes, and we will carry on with Just a Minute. And Paul...
What did you say then?
Those who like to make the historical cinematographic notes.
Oh, all right. Sorry. I just wandered off for a bit. For a minute, I thought you were talking gibberish, but I was wrong.
No, I normally talk gibberish.
That's what confused me. You'd been going for 7 seconds, so I immediately assumed it was rubbish.
You realise now why Paul Merton comes back on the show. There's nobody else to whom he can be so rude except me. Derek, it's your turn to begin. The subject is studs. Will you tell us something? I don't know why they're giving it to you, Derek, but anyway, assure you, if you haven't any experience, you can tell us something about the subject in just a minute, starting now.
I think it's great relief these days that one so seldom wears white tie and tails, because it was always an absolute nightmare trying to get those studs through a stiff-fronted shirt, and the back stud and the front one too, with little things that turned up and always fell off right at the critical moment. Of course, Nicholas Parsons was, in his day, a great stud. A lover.
Used to be... Excuse me, Paul Merton has challenged. I'm dying to know what it is. Yes, Paul?
Just for the listeners, I think they might like to know exactly when your day was.
It was Tuesday, March the 31st, 1944.
Yes, that was one of the days, and there we are, yes. Paul, we enjoyed the challenge, which set up for you, obviously.
I enjoyed it in a way as well.
So we give you a point for a challenge that everybody enjoyed. But as Derek was interrupted, he keeps the subject, he gets a point for being interrupted. He has 38 seconds on studs, starting now.
I think one of the happier things in life would be if one had been a racehorse and won the Derby, and then was immediately retired as a three-year-old to stud. And for absolutely the rest of your days, these marvellous men, the pick of their generation, will be presented to you for you to cover. What's the matter?
This would only be great fun if you were a horse. Unless you are willing to enlighten us about your particular habits.
I did say you'd have to win the Derby and not let
Paul, again, we love the challenge. Another bonus point to you. Derek was interrupted. Another point to him. 22 seconds. Studs with you, Derek, starting now.
Swettenham Stud used to be one of the most successful race establishments in the country, but it hasn't had much good fortune recently. I think, actually, if I was owner of a great horse...
Peter challenged.
Hesitation.
Hesitation. Peter, 12 seconds. Studs with you, starting now.
I used to have to wear stiff collars during the short time that I was away at school, and the best way to soften them is to spit on the buttonholes and rub it with a bit of soap.
Clement Foy challenged.
Deviation.
Why?
Spit on the buttonholes and rub it. Rub what?
Oh, I think that's a little bit too pedantic, really, even for this show, yes.
Rub the spit?
On the buttonholes, yes. There's more than one buttonhole in a collar, there's both sides, so he must have been spitting on the buttonholes. I don't think that was deviation, no, I think that was a very natural thing to do, Peter.
Yes, and it's just as interesting as Peggy Ashcroft's appearance in that bloody film.
So a point to you, Peter, for an incorrect challenge, and you keep the subject, and there's only half a second to go on studs, starting now.
I...
So Peter Jones was speaking as the whistle went, gained that extra point. He's now in second place behind our leader, Clement Freud. And Peter, your turn to begin. The subject, explorers. Tell us something about those intrepid characters in just a minute, starting now.
I always wanted to be an explorer when I was young, and I wanted to go up the Amazon and look for Colonel Fawcett, who was lost there many years ago, if you remember. And then the south part of the hemisphere I wanted to explore in the wake...
Derek Nimmo,
you represent Wanton.
You wanted to do both. You wanted to go up the Amazon.
Oh, yeah, that's right, I did, yes.
So, Derek, a correct challenge. Have the subject, explorers, 45 seconds.
It is so sad there's so little of the world actually to explore. There are only two explorers I've ever met, Gavin.
Peter Jones, a challenge.
There's just as much in the world as there ever was.
Not to explore.
I'm sorry, I agree with Peter, because even you can go to a place which is well known, but you can explore it for yourself for the first time. So you can be an explorer in some area, you can be an explorer up here in Edinburgh if you've never been here before.
That's a tourist, Nicholas.
But they are still exploring the city, because they're the first time they visited here. So, Peter, I agree with your challenge. So you get a point, of course. The subject, 41 seconds, explorers, starting now.
And the nearest I ever got to the South Pole was Dunedin and Invercargill in the southern part of New Zealand. And I must say, it was pretty waste. It was a waste.
Derek Nimmo, challenge. Yes, I agree, right. Yes. 28 seconds, explorers, with you, Derek, starting now.
Wilfred Thesiger, born in Abyssinia, or Ethiopia, perhaps you would like to call it, in 1912, had his 80th birthday a couple of years ago. He actually was last of the great explorers. He's the first man across the empty quarter. And you know, when he went over towards Nizwa, he had to make the camels vomit and drink the muck that was then regurgitated to survive. And I've been along the roads he travelled on the back of the car.
Well, Derek Nimmo, with that disgusting story, brought that round to an end, gained an extra point for speaking as the whistle went, and he's taken the lead, one ahead of Clement Freud. Clement, your turn to begin. Ancient Greece. Will you tell us something about that wonderful place, starting now?
The real trouble about ancient Greece is that they were not on the internet. Although they did have one rather smart thing called Widows 95, which was a sort of geriatric dating agency. Ancient Greece had a language which many of us had to learn at school. It was called Greek and had letters and numbers, which I now forget. Also, I need to drink a glass of water, so if somebody would buzz me.
A new way of playing Just a Minute. Paul, you were the first to buzz, so...
I heard the man, and I buzzed him.
So we interpret that as hesitation. 29 seconds, Paul. Tell us something about ancient Greece, starting now.
The best way to soften collars is to get a camel to vomit on them. And they are then... And this was...
Peter Jones's challenge.
A deviation.
Why?
Well, it's nothing to do with ancient Greece.
Yes, that's what they used to do in ancient Greece.
I don't think they had stiff collars in ancient Greece.
No, because camels used to vomit on them.
You can applaud his wonderful comic invention, but the...
We could learn a lot from them.
Yeah, there weren't many camels in ancient Greece as well. Listen, Paul, I think, to be fair, because the audience loved it, they gave a big round of applause, a bonus point for what you said. Peter Jones gets a point for a correct challenge, takes over the subject, 23 seconds, ancient Greece, starting now.
I've listened to you very carefully, and I'm here to tell you that ancient Greece is that substance which adheres to the ceiling and walls of restaurants that have not been examined by the health authorities. And it's normally called a greasy spoon restaurant. And there are several in this great city, among the other wonderful eating places that we've found.
So Peter Jones, with points in the round, and one for speaking as a whistle went, has leapt forward. He's now in the lead, but only one ahead of the other three. And Paul, your turn to begin. Paul, a flutter. I don't know whether you're a betting man, but tell us something about that subject in just a minute, if you can, starting now.
If you had gone to the bookmakers and placed a £500 bet that my next word would be heliotrope, you have just won yourself a substantial amount of money. Somebody buzzed?
No. Oh, yes! Clement Freud's light came on, but I didn't hear any buzzer. What did you say?
It's a deviation. That isn't a flutter. £500 is a substantial bet.
There's a betting man talking. Clement, a correct challenge, a flutter, with you, 49 seconds, starting now.
I have very little time for flutters. I think if you have a bet, it should be sufficient to give you genuine joy if it wins and polax you in the event of a loss. Lots of people come up and say, did you have a little bit to win on that horse or dog? And I spit. Like a camel, I vomit on folk.
Peter Jones, a challenge.
Hesitation.
Yes, there was, yes. Yes, you definitely hesitated as you were
trying to... I think he was just clearing his throat, to be honest. Right.
I think he was trying to work camels.
In preparation.
I think he was trying to work vomit, camel spit and stiff collars very cleverly.
Same old story, isn't it? Yes.
Peter, a correct challenge. You have the subject. 24 seconds. A flutter, starting now.
If you feel a flutter in your chest, it's very likely that you're having a heart attack. And the best thing to do is to get a pacemaker as fast as you can. Or at any rate, a doctor. If you can't do this, then it's best to lie down for a while until the feeling passes off.
Very good. Interpretation of best.
Did you hear him me say that?
Yes, you did definitely say best.
Ah, yes.
You did repeat it, actually, Peter, yes.
So he may have deprived many people suffering from heart attacks of the means of saving their lives.
I think the audience applause is saying, give Peter Jones a bonus point. But Derek Nimmo got a correct challenge, so he gets a point, and he has 7 seconds on a flutter starting now.
I did have a flutter before I had my quadruple bypass some 10 years ago. And I did go immediately to the Princess Grace Hospital.
So, Derek Nimmo, speaking as the whistle went, has moved forward. He's still just behind Peter Jones, our leader. And Derek, your turn to begin. The subject, Scotch. Oh, what a lovely subject. 60 seconds, starting now.
Now, the Englishman often makes a tremendous mistake and talks about people being Scotch instead of Scottish. But what the correct reference is to is that noble drink, that honey-coloured liquor of which great people all over the world...
Paul Merton challenge.
Liquor?
Hannibal Lecter.
Yes.
Sounds part of a sleazy tabloid headline.
I think definite deviation from the English language as we understand it. Scotch, with you, Paul, 48 seconds, starting now.
I don't particularly like spirits. I don't drink much scotch. Occasionally I've had it with a glass of water mixed in with it. A lot of people say you shouldn't do that, but I understand that is what the connoisseurs do when they are drinking scotch. They mix it with water, which is an exact repetition of what I just said. Word for word.
And Clement Freud was first in, so you admitted word for word.
Paragraph, repetition. It was.
Yeah. But Clement Press first, he's got in on Scotch with 33 seconds to tell us about it, starting now.
Philologically, it is also correct to use the word Scotch in respect of salmon. Smoked fish of that ilk is Scotch and not Scottish. There are two ways of...
Paul challenge.
Hesitation.
Yes, indeed, yes. Right. Scotch is back with you. 20 seconds, Paul, starting now.
How do they get that egg that goes in there that's surrounded by breadcrumbs? I can only assume that they thread into the outer surface and miniaturise the particular thing that comes out of a hen into the middle of it there. And then there you are, you have a marvellous dish which is called a Scotch ovoid. And the thing I like about it is you can drink it with the most beautiful you might get.
But within 1 second ago, you were challenged by Clement Freud.
Deviation. It's not called a Scotch ovoid.
Oh, dear.
Crying.
We all knew what he meant, and he didn't want... The audience has said that it was a clever way of not saying Scotch egg because he couldn't repeat it the word, and we all understood it. So we give you the benefit of the doubt, Paul, and you keep going on Scotch egg with 1.5 seconds to go, starting now.
Ovoid, ovoid, ovoid. Oh.
So at the end of that round, Paul Merton has taken the lead alongside Peter Jones and Paul. Your turn to begin. Megabytes. Tell us something about those in this game, starting now.
Esther Ranson, Ken Dodd, Janet Street Porter. What do these three people have in common? An enormous set of choppers. When they bite into something, it truly is a megabyte. They start by on what bar?
Clement. Yes, we recognise what happened. We interpret it as hesitation. 42 seconds, megabytes with you starting now.
If you watch the lottery programme on a Saturday, you will see, just before they announce the numbers, a woman called Mystic Meg, who tells you who might win. And she's extremely...
A Paul Merton challenge.
Deviation. No mention of megabytes so far.
No, we haven't. He's Meg. Talked about Mystic. No, I know what we're leading to, but I agree with Paul.
What are we leading to?
That, I don't know, but it's something to do with... But I assume that these megabytes has got something to do with Mystic Meg, and he hasn't yet established that. And that's why I'm agreeing with your challenge, but I have to justify my agreement, because otherwise I will not only get letters, but I will get harsh looks from the other three members of the team here. It's not a team, actually, it's a competition. They're working on their own.
megabytes. I thought somebody's working you, though, aren't they?
I know, Elaine's doing a wonderful job, but how she does it with both hands on the table, I don't know.
Oh. There's something deeply unpleasant going on.
No, no. Blushes don't come over well on television and...
Well, on radio. Yeah.
My Scarlet. Advice to Elaine is keep your hands on the table.
Paul, to continue with Just a Minute and Megabytes, I agree with your challenge, which came some time ago, and you have 26 seconds to take over the subject, starting now.
I don't know anything about them.
You lost immediately to Clement Freud. Clement, 24 seconds, Megabytes, starting now.
Hesitation.
Yes, that's right. You got the subject. 24 seconds. Starting now. Paul, you challenge.
Hesitation.
Hesitation, yes, Paul. Second, Megabytes, Paul, starting now.
It's something...
Who challenged? Peter Nimmo.
Hesitation.
No, indeed, no. Paul, another point, 20 points, Megabytes, starting now.
20 points?
Right. 20 minutes. Peter, you challenge.
I can't talk about it for 20 minutes.
Hesitation?
Yes.
Right, yes, 19 seconds on Megabytes with you, Peter, starting now.
Well, you've heard of sound bites, and Megabytes are rather longer versions of that. In fact, they creep into the area of monologues. And instead of the short, quick...
Gary Nimmo challenge.
Hesitation.
There was an there, Peter,
yes,
so
was,
interpret
yes.
that as hesitation. 6 seconds left, Megabytes starting now.
You haven't noticed that nobody wants really to talk about Megabytes because actually we know nothing about them at all. And that is...
Paul challenged.
Repetition of actually.
Yes, you did say actually.
That's the first time I've spoken.
But it was in that bit.
What's
I said
that?
Actually twice.
Yeah. No, you haven't said it in this round.
No, I have not.
No, no,
he said actually.
I generally say
it,
but I haven't said in this round.
And you can repeat words in a different round that you've used before, but not in this round. That is repetition. So, an incorrect challenge. You've got 1 second left, Eric, on Megabytes starting now.
Megabytes are very interesting.
Right. Thank goodness that round is finished. Now, at the end of that round, Paul Merton got quite a number of points, so he's increased his lead. Derek Nimmo, who has moved into second place alongside Peter Jones and Clement Freud for once, is trailing a little behind them. Derek, your turn to begin the subject, cheek. Will you tell us something about cheek in just a minute, starting now?
Do you know that really is a most extraordinary coincidence? Because just before the programme started, I was talking about cheeks with Sir Clement Freud. In fact, we were reminiscing about a visit to a little island called Poitoy, and he was given a garoupa fish there, and... into the fish he plunged with his...
A Paul Merton challenge.
Repetition of fish.
Yep. Yes. Absolutely right.
Fish, yes.
Well, listen.
Another point to...
into the fish he plunged.
Well, yeah. he plunges chopsticks.
I don't know. It's worse than the camels.
Right, another point to Peter. We enjoyed that. But Paul has a subject, a point for a correct challenge. 44 seconds on cheek, Paul, starting now.
Well, I well remember the old Fred Astaire song, Dancing Cheek to Cheek, and it was one of those films that starred him and Ginger Rogers that RKO used to make quite a lot of in the 1930s, and they were seen as a very good dancing couple on the big silver screen. A programme I used to like as a child was The Clivero Kid, starring Jimmy of that name, because he was a cheeky little schoolboy. I didn't realise at the time he was actually 85 and a midget, but you don't know when you're 11 years old that these sort of things are going on. And I used to enjoy that programme immensely. It was very well written and very...
Peter, you challenge.
Well, he's got away from cheek altogether with the Clitheroe kid and all these figures from the past.
But he also repeated very.
Oh, he did?
Yes.
Well...
Which is what I thought you were challenging for. I mean...
that was my first choice, but I changed my mind in midair.
So, Peter, you have a correct challenge. 7 seconds, cheek, starting now.
They cut the cheek off cows' heads and make it into a kind of brawn, though this is forbidden.
Yes. So, Peter Jones, gaining points, also won for speaking as a whistle went, has moved forward. He's now equal in the lead with Paul Merton, and we're moving into the final round. And just behind them, only 3 points, Derek Nimmo, and then just behind him, Clement Freud. It could be anybody's contest, though again, are the points important? To the players, yes, but not, I think, to the listeners.
We're wasting our time, then.
Peter, would you start the final round, ferreting? 60 seconds, as usual, starting now.
This is a sport, so-called, that I've never actually indulged in, but it involves putting ferrets down holes and trying to pelt...
All challenged.
Hesitation.
Yes, there was, yes. Yes. What were you trying to do with those ferrets?
Paralyse the rabbits.
Paralyse the rabbits?
Well, as soon as they see a ferret, they can't move, you see. They're frightened to death.
Oh, I thought they ran out the other burrow, their escape hatch.
Well, if there is one, but I mean...
Didn't you know that every rabbit makes an escape hatch? They have three or four.
How long have we got on this?
Paul, a correct challenge, 50 seconds. Ferreting, starting now.
In country fairs up and down the United Kingdom during the summer, you'll often see people sticking Nicholas Parsons down their trousers. And this is regarded as a rather cruel sport these days because the poor creature doesn't know where it is at the best of times. Never mind being encased in some particular tweed legging.
Derek, challenge.
I think I must challenge on the grounds of deviation. I can't imagine you being pushed down tweed trousers.
I've enjoyed it, actually. Especially some of the people who were wearing them. No, actually, I agree. It's a very devious thought and a very devious idea.
Are you denying it?
Yeah. Right. Derek, 31 seconds. Ferreting starting now.
I've been trying to shove ferrets down mole holes, but they won't go. They're too big and I can't get rid of them at all. Only ferrets will work with rats and rabbits. And jolly good they are. So if you have any problem with those particular vermin, give me a ring. 373-521.
Three. Clement Freud challenge.
Repetition of three.
373. So, Clement, 10 seconds are left to tell us something about ferreting starting now.
The most important thing about ferreting is to have a ferret. And these are most engaging animals. They really have a sort of yellowish
Peter
sheen.
Peter Jones, a challenge.
Hesitation.
Yes, I thought that was a little hesitation. And, Peter, you've cleverly got in with 2 seconds to go on ferreting starting now.
It can also describe
challenge,
somebody...
Clement Freud, challenge.
Deviation.
Why?
He didn't say well. He always says well before he says anything.
I only had 2 seconds, you know. I couldn't hang about.
Well.
You could have said well, well.
The audience applause indicates that you deserve a bonus point, Clement. But Peter was interrupted, so he gets a point for that. And he has 1 second on ferreting starting now.
Searching and looking for something.
Right. Well. So, as I said a little while ago, this was to be the last round, so let me give you the final score. It's a very interesting situation. They all contributed so much, and they all gained a lot of points. But for the contributions, the points were that Clement Freud for once finished in fourth place, 1 point behind Derek Nimmo, who was just behind Paul Merton. But at that last surge forward of Peter Jones, rushing for the tape, he got there ahead of all the rest. So this week, with most points, Peter, we say you are the winner. A popular win. And you had to come to Edinburgh to achieve it, Peter, but nonetheless. So it only remains to say thank you to our 4 outstanding players of this game, Paul Merton, Clement Freud, Peter Jones and Derek Nimmo. I also thank Elaine Widley. I'm sorry I made her blush halfway through the show, but she kept the score magnificently, blew the whistle most delicately and smartly. We also thank our producer, Anne Jobson. But we thank Ian Messiter for thinking of the game and also keeping us going like he does. I also must thank this wonderful, delightful audience and the festival fringe here at the Pleasance in Edinburgh, and from me, Nicholas Parsons, on all of us until we take to the air to play Just a Minute once more. Goodbye and thank you. Welcome to Just a Minute. My name is Nicholas Parsons, and as the minute waltz fades away, once more it is my pleasure to welcome the four talented players who are going to perform in Just a Minute this week. We welcome back two players of the younger generation, one of our regulars, Paul Merton, and with him someone who's only played the game once before, that is Neil Mullarkey. We also welcome back two of the original players of the game, right from the very first time 29 years ago, that is Derek Nimmo and Peter Jones. Will you please welcome all four of them? And beside me sits Yolanta Zabuki, who's going to keep a score and blow a whistle when 60 seconds are up. And this particular edition of Just a Minute is coming from the lovely Swan Theatre on the beautiful River Severn in the historic city of Worcester. As usual, I'm going to ask our four players to speak on a subject that I will give them, and they will try and do that without hesitation, repetition, or deviating. And we'll begin the show this week with Derek Nimmo. Oh, the subject for you, very apt, sauce. Will you tell us something about sauce in this game, starting now?
Sauce for the goose is sauce for the gander. But what better sauce is there in the whole wide world than Leon Perrin's Worcestershire sauce? Absolutely essential if you're going to make a really good Bloody Mary. To have that together with vodka, Tabasco, some horseradish, lemon juice, put it all together and mix it round. And you will have a drink fit for James Bond himself. Much better than those dry martinis. Other kinds of sauce that one can think of course, are the ones, people being rather saucy, rather naughty. I remember when I was here...
Paul Merton,
challenge. Repetition of rather.
Yeah, rather saucy, rather naughty. Yes. So, Paul, you got in. You have a correct challenge. You get a point for that, of course. And there are 23 seconds left to tell us something about sauce, starting now.
I like all kinds of sauce, really. Tomato ketchup, I think, is extremely nice.
Peter Jones' challenge.
Hesitation.
Yes, there was a little hesitation before the run out with the ketchup there. So, Peter, you've got in on sauce with 19 seconds available, starting now.
I've always believed that hunger is the best sauce. It's an old saying from the Middle East. And white sauce is the most popular, or was, until newer cuisine.
The new Mullarkey challenge.
That was a mistake. I just want to say how mild it is to be working with you, Peter.
Right. Neil, an incorrect challenge, so Peter, you get a point for that. You keep the subject. You have 8 seconds on sauce, starting now.
You make it.
Paul Merton challenge.
I would just like to second what Neil said.
What are they up to?
They're all remarking on the privilege it gives them to work with you, Peter. You know, you're one of the doyens of show business. One of the cult figures, you might almost say. So,
what was that again?
Cult!
Yes.
That was an incorrect challenge, you'll be surprised to hear, Paul. So, Peter, you have another point, and you have sauce still. 6 seconds, starting now.
You heat a knob of butter the size of a pigeon's egg or a walnut, whichever you happen to have handy to measure it by. Add some flour.
Whoever is speaking when the whistle goes gains an extra point, and on this occasion it was Peter Jones. And you won't be surprised to hear that at the end of that round, Peter has got a commanding lead over all the others.
God.
Yes, yes. Don't let it go to your head, Peter. Keep it up.
Well.
Paul Merton, will you take the next round? The subject is painting the town red. Will you tell us something about that idea, that subject, in just a minute, starting now?
You would need an awful lot of paint, I suppose, because you have to consider first there is the undercoat, and then eventually you put the top thing on...
Peter Jones' challenge.
Well, he did hesitate again.
51 seconds, Peter. Painting the town red, starting now.
Apart from going mad and having a wonderful time with a lot of lager louts, I think it must really mean painting it red on the map so that you know where it is, this particular place. And if...
new Mullarkey challenge.
I believe there was hesitation there.
There was definite hesitation.
As much as it hurts me to buzz, such a doyen of the theatre... I would have said doyen.
Well, of course, you're better educated than I am, I assume. Painting the town red is with you, Neil, starting now.
Painting the town...
Oh, gosh, what was that, Peter?
Hesitation.
Yes, right, Peter. You have the subject back.
I wasn't sure. Did you say how many seconds I have?
No, I did say, actually.
Okay, well,
You have such respect for Peter Jones, I'm sure you don't mind the fact that you hesitated. Painting the Town Red is with you, Peter, and there are 37 seconds starting now.
Well, I suppose the part of the town that is normally red doesn't exist in this particular city.
I'm very Nimmo challenged.
Well, he stopped.
He did, yes. He tried to think if it might be right or not.
Well, I was trying to make it pleasant.
Yes. 28 seconds, Derek. Tell us something about Painting the Town Red, starting now.
I first came to Worcester at the Theatre Royal in 1953. And gosh, did I paint the town red. It was my first big break to be in this magnificent...
Neil Mullarkey, chance.
I think you said first twice.
It was your first. First time you came, your first big break.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. 19 seconds, Neil, on Painting the Town Red, starting now.
Painting the Town Red is exactly what I did with Nicholas Parsons so many years ago at St. Andrews. He let me wear his slacks to play on the old course. He was the rector of the university, my what a...
Paul Merton challenge.
That's not my definition of painting the town red. Wearing a pair of Nicholas Parsons slacks.
All I can tell you is that you were not there. Right, 8 seconds. You got another point for that, Neil. Painting the town red. Continue, starting now.
He treated us to a meal of chicken in a basket and a half bottle of Liebfrau Milch, watered down with old man spritzer. Yes, I like the sound.
Paul Merton challenge.
What's old man spritzer?
That's what I wanted.
What's that?
It's, whatever it is, it's very likely he's got it.
It's a very spirited way for an elderly man to behave. Right. Paul, you've got him with 1 second on Painting the Town Red, starting now.
I would start with a...
Paul was speaking as the whistle went. Gained an extra point. Peter Jones still in the lead. Equal in second place are Paul Merton and Neil Mullarkey. Then Derek Nimmo and Neil Mullarkey. Your turn to begin. The subject is marbles.
Marbles.
Marbles. Tell us something about marbles in this game, starting now.
The other day, I picked up the Elgin marbles in the Portobello Market. The marbles currently residing in the British Museum are a fake. I bought these particular marbles for £5. Yummy, I said as I took delivery.
Derek Nimmo's chance.
Deviation. He couldn't have possibly lifted them up. They're too heavy.
Well, it was obviously a complete flight of fantasy. So you continue with 46 seconds. Marbles, starting now, Neil.
I had a forklift truck and took them to my house and displayed them on the mantel as they covered the beautiful, ornate woodwork. I decided that indeed I should be king of Greece. Such was my dignity.
Peter Jones, a challenge.
Hesitation.
The audience say yes, all right. 31 seconds. Peter on marbles, starting now.
Well, he put them on the mantelpiece, did he say? I can't understand that, although I don't really believe he had a forklift truck either.
But Paul Merton challenged.
Hesitation.
Yes, I'm afraid there was, Peter.
Yes, there was.
You hadn't even gone on to marbles either.
No.
23 seconds with you, Paul, on marbles, starting now.
I remember it as a game that we used to play when I was about 7 years old in school. I can't really exactly remember what worked.
Neil Mullarkey challenge.
Remember.
Yes.
Yes, he was remembering too little. 16 seconds, starting now.
The police came round. Have you got the Elgin marbles? Yes, I have.
And Derek Nimmo challenge.
Repetition of Elgin.
Elgin marbles, you mentioned it before, sorry.
Shucks.
Derek, 12 seconds on marbles, starting now.
I always think we were frightfully lucky that Lord Elgin brought them back to this country, because those silly old Greeks, they'd have all turned to dust by now. And we have them beautifully preserved in the British Museum, not only for the Greek tourists coming. I said Greek twice.
Peter Jones,
a
challenge.
Yeah, repetition of Greeks.
Yes, and well done, Peter. You got in cleverly with 1 second to go on marbles, starting now.
Oh, I think several lost it.
Well, at the moment, this is a runaway thing for Peter Jones. He's way out in the lead, and he's increased his lead at the end of that round. And he also begins the next round. The subject is composers. Peter, tell us something about those in just a minute, starting now.
Well, apart from the obvious ones like Mozart and Bach and Beethoven, my mind goes to those wonderful Americans of the first part of this century, like Jerome Kern and Irving Berlin, Vincent Humans, and dozens of others. And I think how impoverished they must have left the eastern part of Europe, Russia in particular. Why did they let all those wonderful people with their mat...
Oh, Derek, no more challenge.
It was wonderful.
Yes, they were wonderful, yes, but you were. Did repeat it, I'm
I
afraid,
did,
Peter.
Yes.
Derek, you've got him with 35 seconds to go. Tell us something about composers, starting now.
I suppose being in Worcester, one thinks automatically of Elgar and that fine statue by Kenneth Potts outside the cathedral here. But it was actually created by the son-in-law of Mimi Hewitt, who lived in Britannia Square when I was here in the theatre. And she's in the audience tonight. I do think we ought to give her a very special round of applause because she's 78 years old. But Elgar, when he used to walk around the hills...
Neil Mullarkey challenge.
I think you said Elgar.
He did. You did repeat Elgar. Yes.
We're not going to have applause for everybody who's 78 on this panel, are we? We've been here all night.
Composers is with you, Neil. 12 seconds are available starting now.
My favourite composers are Noel Gallagher of Oasis, R.E.M., Mick Jones and Joe Strummer of The Clash. Oh, no, nothing of these European fellows with their strange-sounding surnames. I let the composers off today.
Neil Mullarkey was speaking then as Whistlewind gained that extra point for doing so, and he has moved forward. He's now in second place, only just behind our leader, who is still Peter Jones. Derek, will you take the next round? The subject is Brussels. Will you tell us something about Brussels in just a minute, starting now?
I think to have been at the Duchess of Richmond's ball on the eve of Waterloo in Brussels must have been an extraordinary occasion.
Paul Merton Chalmers.
It was boring. But the band didn't turn up and we had peanuts till midnight.
Give Paul a bonus point because we enjoyed the challenge, but as Derek was interrupted, he keeps the subject. 53 seconds for you, Derek. Brussels, starting now.
Why are we governed by Brussels? If it was put to a referendum, would we not opt to join something else than the common market? I cannot imagine how they even tell us not to send smoked salmon by post. London buses, last week, they want to put on doors at the back so you can't stand on the footplate anymore.
Neil Mullarkey and Paul Merton, both flights came on together. So I'm going to have to ask you, who wants to be generous and give way? Right, Neil, Paul's given way to you.
Paul's
as you
given
haven't
way
the game
to me,
before.
And
right.
I'll give him some money later. But I think Derek might have hesitated.
I think he did, actually, yes. And there are 33
You're
seconds.
Light, isn't he, Rich? Young fellow.
I want to be
light.
Invited back again. And I'd love to come back to Worcester again. Just trying the Derek Nimmo tack.
Yes.
I know some people who are very old, and Worcester's great.
It's working well, but I think you're overplaying your hand at the moment.
Yes,
right. 33 seconds, Neil, on Brussels, starting now.
Brussels, the place where Karl Marx wrote the Communist Manifesto by a fire in a café at La Grande Place. Charlotte Bronte renamed it Villette, a place where the Palais de Justice...
Paul Merton challenge.
Competition of place.
There were too many places, I'm afraid.
Well, there were chips.
Yes. 22 seconds, Paul, with you. Brussels, starting now.
I've never really liked sprouts. I think it's down to the fact that I don't cook them very well. I was living in a bedsit in the early 1980s, and these particular vegetables were quite cheap, and I don't think you're actually meant to boil them for 24 hours before you consume them. So I would like to now give you my recipe for the perfect Brussels... I suddenly thought I couldn't say Brussels again.
I know. It's a tough game. And, Derek, you've got him with 2 seconds to go on Brussels, starting now.
The Duke of Wellington left early
and,
in the evening.
And Neil Mullarkey challenge.
Sorry, but didn't you say Duke earlier?
No.
Duke of Richmond.
No. Duchess of Richmond's ball, I said.
Yeah,
I'm just giving the cast list now.
I apologise.
You don't
can I come back again? I love
all that
Worcester.
Never apologise in just a minute, because what happens is he gets another point because he was interrupted, and he has 1 second on Brussels, starting now.
Lord Uxbridge.
So Derek Nimmo gained a number of points in that round, including one for speaking as a whistle went and has moved forward, and they're all almost equal, but just one point ahead is Peter Jones still. Paul Merton, your turn to begin the subject, the supernatural. Can you tell us something about that in this game, starting now?
I would like to take this minute to think about something in my mind, a household object, and if you, the audience, can pick up what that particular thing is, that would be indeed some kind of psychic phenomena. So here we go. You've just ruined an experiment.
Repetition.
Repetition.
Yes, he was thinking the same thought twice.
It was one continuous thought.
Neil, you have a correct challenge. You have the supernatural. 42 seconds, starting now.
The supernatural can be blamed for many things. The rise of the Shane Ritchie experience is another. The demise of the Nolans. The success...
Paul Merton,
a lot of these in there. The Nolans, the demise, the Shane Ritchie experience, the paranormal,
We let it go once, maybe twice, but if it's consistent, then we say repetition. 33 seconds. Back with you, Paul, on the supernatural. Starting now.
Allow me to pick up from where we left off. Did anyone see a house then? A house with a chimney?
It's a new way of playing, just a minute, but Derek, you challenged that time first.
I wasn't allowing him.
You what?
He said, allow me to pick up where I left off, so I buzzed.
And you weren't allowing him.
I'm sorry. Anyway. It doesn't really matter, Nicholas.
No. 28 seconds, the supernatural with you, Derek, starting now.
Nicholas is living proof that there is life after death. When you see him sitting on this...
Paul Merton challenged.
You call that life?
Oh, really? And this audience applauds.
It's only a 12-volt battery that keeps him going.
You weren't like this when I did my one-man show up, yeah?
Well, didn't nobody laugh then?
Really? Maybe this is the reason I have the job. I'm the only person in show business who will take these particular insults and come back again. Right.
For the money you get, yes.
Any more cues you want for gags, Paul? Right. 21 seconds, Paul. Show you how generous and genuine I am for you to take over the subject of the supernatural starting now.
In 1972, Uri Geller appeared for the first time on British television with his spoon-bending trick. I describe it as such because I don't think there's anything paranormal going on there at all. Conjurers can imitate most of the stunts that the aforementioned Israeli...
Peter Jones challenge.
Hesitation.
I think it was, Peter, yes. You have 5 seconds. You've got in with only 5 seconds to go, and the supernatural is the subject, and you start now.
In my lifelong quest for knowledge, I attended a seance at the Wigmore Hall.
You were speaking as the whistle went, Peter, gained an extra point for doing so, and you are now 2 points ahead of all the others who are equal in second place. Neil Mullarkey, will you take the next round? What makes me blush? Will you tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now?
What makes me blush is the fact that I am frequently mistaken for Will Carling, the former captain of the English rugby team. It is embarrassing trying...
Peter, you challenge, yes.
He's not captain, he's ex-captain.
He was captain, he's now the ex-captain, I'm afraid.
I think I said former.
Did say former. Captain.
Former means he was.
I never heard you say former.
Well, you are deaf, we've already established that. So.
You said the former captain? Oh, well, then let's take all that back and start again.
Well, Paul heard it, didn't he?
Yeah, he did say former.
You continue with 46 seconds on what makes me blush, starting now.
What makes me blush most is people coming up and asking for my autograph. Your autograph, please, Mr. Brad.
Paul Merton challenge.
Repetition of autograph.
I know, once he thought of his autograph, he couldn't stop repeating it. Right, 41 seconds, Paul. What makes me blush, starting now.
I have this terrible habit of imagining newsreaders in the nude. I first started started performing this particular...
Peter Jones, a challenge.
Hesitation.
Yes, I would agree with that one, Peter.
I'd like to hear more. Yes.
But the trouble is, I have to be fair within the rules of just a minute, and there was a hesitation, and Peter's got in with 33 seconds on what makes me blush, starting now.
Well, certainly sitting in front of a roaring fire tends to make my face red, but nothing I ever hear on Just a Minute would make me blush. I'm trying to think of something on television that I may have seen. One or two programmes, very late at night, if one can stay awake long enough, they do tend to bring blood to the cheeks. But otherwise, I don't think there is anything. After a certain number of years, when you've lived, you've seen a lot of excitement and non-events.
Paul Merton challenge.
This is deviation, and if the subject is what makes me blush, and then Peter says there's nothing that makes him blush.
Yes.
So it must be a deviation.
Well, that is a difficult decision, isn't it? What makes me blush, and he says there's nothing that makes me blush. I think I have to give you the benefit of the doubt, Paul, and say you have 5 seconds on what makes me blush, starting now.
Trevor MacDonald in a two-piece swimsuit. If such a thing can be conjured to the mind, then you'll have some idea.
So, Paul Merton was speaking as the whistle went, gained that extra point, another point in the round. He's 1 point behind our leader, Peter Jones, and in third place, equal are Derek Nimmo and Neil Mullarkey. And Peter, it's your turn to begin again. The subject, a big hit. Will you tell us something about that? You can talk about one of your personal ones, if you like. 60 seconds, starting now.
No, I won't talk about my personal ones, because I've got to keep going for a whole minute. And if you hit the cricket ball in the Worcestershire county ground and it landed near the cathedral, that would be a big hit. And it would probably get you into the papers. I don't know how far it is, but a big hit in the theatre, of course, is a difficult matter to discuss because you can run for a year and still the management lose money. Of course, it's all terribly dishonest and crooked, and you don't get any prizes for guessing who the villains are. They're certainly not the actors. Now, if I can...
Neil Mullarkey challenge.
I think he hesitated.
I think he did as well, Neil. So you have the subject. 22 seconds are available. A big hit starting now.
Imagine the scene, 1972, Shea Stadium. There am I, a little boy, watching a baseball game. A big hit is required. It is achieved.
Peter Jones challenged.
No, it wasn't 1972. He got the idea from Paul Merton, who said that Geller appeared first on television in 1972. It wasn't a very eventful year altogether.
What's your challenge, Peter?
He seems to know more about my life than I do.
Yes. Have you had one of these supernatural experiences that Paul's been talking about?
Not lately, no, I haven't. No, I do know Trevor MacDonald rather well.
But that was... That was one of his supernatural blushing experiences. Neil, I'm with you. 13 seconds available. A big hit starting now.
Jim Beecham hit a home run, although his name should have been pronounced Beauchamp. The Americans insisted on this rather.
Derek Nimmo, challenge.
Traditional American.
Yes, you mentioned America before.
Yeah.
And, Derek, you've got him 6 seconds on a big hit starting
when
now.
When Nicholas Parsons played the Swan Theatre in Worcester, he was the most enormous hit. People cheered him all the way from the stage door into a great limousine, and he went driving back to the metropolis, throbbing with excitement, roars sounding in his ears, because there's never been a bigger hit than Worcester than...
Derek, actually, you were challenged, but I let you go on, because I thought the audience were enjoying it. But Peter did actually challenge you. Peter, what was your challenge?
So long ago.
But I know it was correct.
I think it was for his own good. I thought he'd burst a blood vessel or something, you know.
So you have 2 seconds on a big hit, Peter, starting now.
Well, I think Nicholas is...
So Peter Jones managed to speak just before, and just as the whistle went, and gained an extra point. He is just a little bit further ahead now of Paul Merton and Neil Mullarkey in second place, and only 1 point behind them is Derek Nimmo. Paul, and it's your turn to begin. A good sport. Will you tell us something about a good sport, or a good sport, or someone who knew who might be a good sport? 60 seconds, starting now.
Bowls is a good sport, because unlike Grand Prix racing, you're unlikely to crash at 125 miles an hour. It seems to me that the luxurious grass that you can often play this game on is perfectly suited to that fine, delicate balance where you have to judge whether your particular bowl is closer to somebody else's or whether they're going to nip in behind you. I've never played it, but I'm thoroughly looking forward to the day when I first take up this remarkably good game.
Neil Mullarkey challenge.
I think it's a game twice.
You said game right at the beginning, I'm afraid, Paul.
Did I say sport at the beginning?
No, I think you did mention game twice. I think you did.
I'm quite prepared to mention it twice if it helps the edit.
I think it's sport at the beginning, then you said game later, and then...
I probably did.
Yes, you
well,
did.
Well, I'm prepared to have bareback wrestling if you want to.
Well, let's get this out of the way first.
Right. So, I'll put it to the audience, if you like.
What?
Me and Neil...
Not back
they,
to that
they
subject
can't
again.
All come, I mean...
Neil, 30 seconds on a good sport, starting now.
A good sport is a phrase for somebody who's prepared to take a joke. Now, frankly, I find this is sometimes an excuse to allow people who do not have any time for debauchery and immoral behaviour to be shunned from polite society. I find it reprehensible...
Paul Merton challenge.
Repetition of I find.
I find, you did say that, yes, yes. A good sport is back with you. 13 seconds, Paul, starting now.
I used to like playing badminton, knocking the old shuttlecock across the net, because the great thing about that particular sport is you don't have to be that good at it, unlike tennis.
Peter Jones's challenge.
Repetition of that.
Yes, yes, that's right. You did say that a lot. That sport, that game, that thing, that thing. So, Peter, you've got him with 3 seconds to go. A good sport starting now.
I know one, but I'm not going to tell you who she is.
You were speaking as the whistle went, Peter, gained an extra point for doing so, and it now remains for me to give the final score. Well, Derek Nimmo, who has won many times in the 29 years we've been playing this game, didn't do so well this week. But again, as I've said before, it is the contribution and not the points. Would you not agree?
Yes.
So Derek gave his usual fine contribution. Neil Mullarkey, who's only played it once before, then came in with his outstanding contribution. Paul Merton, who's played it quite a bit before, came out with his eccentric and delightful and original contribution. And Peter Jones, who has played it before, but doesn't often come out with the most points, but he's achieved it this week, 1 point ahead of all the others, Peter Jones. Only remains for me to thank all four of them for the wonderful contribution they give, and must also thank Yolanda Zabuki for keeping the score so well and blowing her whistle, also Ian Messiter, who created the game, and Jobson, who produces and directs the show, and from me, Nicholas Parsons, goodbye. Tune in the next time we take to the air and play Just a Minute. Welcome to Just a Minute. Hello, my name is Nicholas Parsons, and as the Minute Waltz
fades away. Once more, it is my pleasure to welcome the four talented people who this week are going to play Just a Minute. We welcome back one of our regular players of the game who joined us a few years ago and has done so well we daren't let him go, and that is Paul Merton. We welcome back someone who's only played the game twice before, and he did it so well we had to ask him back again, and that is Graham Norton. And there is two others who have played the game for 28 years, and we can't do without them. That is Peter Jones and Clement Freud. Would you please welcome all four of them? Beside me sits Elaine Wigley, who's going to keep the score and blow a whistle when 60 seconds are up. And as usual, I will ask our four players to speak, if they can, on the subject that I give them. And they will try and do that without hesitation, repetition or deviation, the rules of the game. See what happens as we start the show this week with Clement Freud and the subject, tripe. Will you tell us something about tripe in just a minute, starting now?
I think it is proper to say that taramasalata is the biggest sexual stimulant that we have in the Western world. A man in Newport Pagnell ate his own weight of this confection of smoked cod's roe, lemon juice, sunflower oil, spices, herbs, and...
Paul Merton, new challenge.
Hesitation?
Yes, it was hesitation. I think he was waiting for someone to challenge him for deviation, actually. Nothing happened. But he paused. That is hesitation. There are 38 seconds left. The subject is tripe, Paul. It is with you.
Of course, Clement was talking tripe. That's what he was on about as regards the sexual affection... What was that word?
Peter, what is your challenge?
Hesitation.
Hesitation. Yes, indeed, he did hesitate. There are 32 seconds left. The subject is tripe, with you starting now.
Well, I've been associated with tripe for many years. As an actor, you really can't avoid it. And you're often given a lot of tripe to talk or speak or act even. And the...
Clement Freud has challenged.
Repetition of oars.
Of oars?
Oh, well, no, not two letters.
No. You did say it three times. I have to be fair within the rules of just a minute. I agree with you. It's a bit of a tough challenge. But, Clement, it was a correct challenge. So...
Boring as well.
20 seconds. Back with you is tripe, starting now.
Tripe is the edible lining of a ruminant's stomach and is pretty disgusting unless you like that sort of thing. In the East End of London, they cook it in something called liquor, which contains the juices of the meat mixed with parsley or other herbs. Thank you.
Whoever is speaking when the whistle goes gains an extra point. On this occasion, it was Clement Freud, so he has 2 points at the end of that round. Paul Merton also has a point because he was had a correct challenge, and he takes the second subject, which is the cat's whisker. Will you tell us something about the cat's whisker in just a minute, Paul, starting now?
This is a term for a very old-fashioned sort of radio that was very popular in the 1920s and 30s. People would sit around their sets on a Wednesday afternoon listening to the great dance bands of the time, such groups as Sir Clement Freud's Hawaiian Five and Peter Jones' Syncopated Six. It was a wonderful time for all fans of this kind of popular tune, and people would often come...
Peter Jones' challenge.
That's the second time he said and.
Yeah, but you should get back at Clement on those sort of challenges. It's not Paul.
But it wasn't Clement, it wasn't talking, so it was difficult.
I know, he wasn't talking, yeah. But no, he did repeat and a number of times.
Well, I only did it to show what a ridiculous challenge it is.
As he repeated people as well, we'll give it to you, Peter, and so you have 33 seconds on the cat's whiskers starting now.
Cat's whiskers are the same width as the cat behind them. And so, when a cat tries to... I've repeated cat. Just in case anybody's...
repeated cat.
I know, but cat is on the card, and you can repeat the words on the card.
Oh, no, it's cat's on the card.
Yeah, cat's but it's whiskers. Apostrophe S, it's cat. So
well, it's a different word. Cat, C-A-T, is cat, and cat is C-A-T, apostrophe S. How can it be the same?
Well, because cat is on the card.
Are you saying that the apostrophe S doesn't matter?
Not when it's on the card.
Well, no, when it's on the card. If it said on the card, I'm a lunatic, you'd believe it, wouldn't you?
If he said whisk, that is also on the card, and I would allow you to use the word whisk more than once.
What is he talking about?
Whisk. You would give me an impossible decision, actually, if you did that. But cat and is on the card because you've got cat or cats. I think I must give the benefit of the doubt to Peter Jones, since he keeps the subject. He has another point. He has 23 seconds, starting now.
So when a cat approaches a hole or aperture, it knows if the whiskers stick out further than the hole, the cat...
Paul Merton Jarland.
A repetition of whisk.
Whisk is on the card.
Whisk and hole.
Right. Yes, repetition of hole. 14 seconds, Paul. The cat's whisker starting now.
Whisk, 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 whisk is what I call my... Who buzz now? We've established the rules. We've established that we can repeat whisk as often as we like.
But not ad infinitum like that.
Well, three isn't ad infinitum, is it?
No, you did it more than three times.
I said whisk, whisk, whisk. That's three times.
No, you said whisk, 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 whisk.
Oh, right, five. That's not ad infinitum, is it?
Clement, you have a correct challenge.
Well, it's nobody's challenges yet.
Yes, it is. Repetition of whisk.
Oh.
You could only use one word. 10 seconds, Clement, starting now.
The very best way to remove whiskers from a cat is to take the feline animal to a barber with a pair of scissors and snip it off.
On that very sorry thought, we come to the end of that round, and Clement Freud was speaking as the whistle went, so he gained an extra point. He has increased his lead at the end of the round. Peter Jones in second place, then Paul Merton, and Graham has yet to speak. but wait till he gets going. Peter Jones, will you take the next round? The subject is snap. Will you tell us something about snap in just a minute, starting now?
Well, it's a funny word because it can be used in so many different ways. Verbs, like snap, is a rather bitter, irritable retort to a question. And then snapping a pencil in half, for instance. Or then cold snaps, of course. And brandy snaps. Or
Graham, the Norton challenge.
Hey, that was a repetition of snaps. I hate to be picky. But it
yes, the subject is snap, and he repeated snaps. Well done, Graham.
Was I right?
Yes, you're right.
Good. Nice this seems to have changed since the cat's rule. But there's no moment of inconsistency in your judgments.
If there was, you wouldn't have all the ammunition to come back and be so amusing and facetious, Paul. subject is with you. 41 seconds. Snap, Graham, starting now.
Very little can make me snap, apart from fat children, really. When I'm sitting on a bus and one of those rotund infants comes in and sits opposite me, I try to be nice and have sympathetic thoughts like how difficult to be a young person in that pudgy state. But something within me wants to reach out...
Clement Freud challenge.
Two somethings.
Clement, you had a correct challenge. You also have 19 seconds. The subject is snap, starting now.
Snap is a very useful game to play with Peter Jones because when two cards show the same picture or number, he always begins by saying, well, after which you can say snap before he gets it in. Therefore, you succeed and the aforementioned colleague...
And Peter Jones challenged.
I think he's making a personal attack on me.
So what is your
deviation?
I don't think he was deviating from the subject of snap. He did hesitate, didn't he?
Yes.
Well done. very cleverly got in with half a second to go on snap, starting now.
I always...
At the end of that round, Clement Freud, gaining points, has increased his lead by one over Peter Jones, who's in second place, then Paul Merton, then Graham Norton. And Graham, your turn to begin. The subject, ecstasy. Oh, the audience are looking forward to you telling them something about ecstasy, Graham, starting now.
I once very nearly achieved a state of ecstasy, but then my mother burst into the bedroom and removed the
book I was reading, entitled Grimble at Christmas, written by the very lovely Clement Freud. This superb tome has whipped me into states of excitement and pleasure I can hardly describe, but my God, I'm going to try. I have spent many winter evenings curled in front of a fire, hugging my knees with pure pleasure as I recall this lovely short book novella, if you will.
A poor challenge.
Repetition of book, sadly.
Oh, yes, yes.
I'm a fool to myself.
You did go for 40 seconds. That's very good. It's the best we've had today yet. And you, Paul, correct challenge. 20 seconds are available. Ecstasy, starting now.
My idea of high fun would be to go to a fun fair somewhere.
Yes? What is your
challenge? Was it me?
Yes, it is you. You got in first.
Too many funds.
Yes, fun fair, yes. Ecstasy is back with you, so as rapidly as that. 15 seconds available, Graham, starting now.
Money can't buy you love. Nor can you purchase happiness, but you can buy ecstasy.
Clement challenged.
Repetition.
Of what?
Bye.
Yes, you're quite right. He did say bye, unfortunately. He's working up to that very good gag, but he had to use bye twice. 7 seconds available for you, Clement, on ecstasy, starting now.
It's very odd that words like ecstasy, joy, dinner.
Clement challenged.
Well, there isn't a word like ectotity, either.
So you'd call that a deviation from...
Well, I suppose there is a word like ecstasy. It's ecstasy.
It's a deviation from the word, as we understand it. And there's 4 seconds available for you, Graham, on ecstasy, starting now. Peter Jones has challenged.
Hesitation.
Yes, of course, Peter. 2 seconds for you on ecstasy, starting now.
Whatever it is, it doesn't last very long.
Peter Jones, speaking as a whistle, Wayne gained that extra point, and he has now leapt forward to join Clement Freud in the lead, and then Graham Norton and Paul Merton are equal in second place. Clement Freud, it is your turn to begin. The subject is going for a song. 60 seconds as usual, starting now.
A man came to me at the fair and said, if you've a poet's tongue, tumble up and chant the air, so the birds of morning hum, I'll pay you if you sing it well. A penny piece, I answered flat. Sixpence is the proper price for a ballad such as that. I learnt this in a detention at school because I had been doing something I should not have done.
Paul Merton challenged.
Hesitation?
Yes, breathing. Indeed,
yes. He thought of what he shouldn't have done and paused. 35 seconds are available for you, Paul. Going for a song, starting now.
Lots of people go for a song. They love musicals. Andrew Lloyd Webber's work is still packing out the West End shows, such as Cats and Miss Saigon and all these kind of blockbuster...
Peter Challenge.
I don't think he wrote Saigon.
No, he didn't.
No, he didn't write. When you have to keep going on just a minute under pressure, sometimes those sort of things slip up. But you pick it up, Peter, and you are going to play this game of just a minute. 24 seconds, starting now.
People all over the world flock to the...
Paul Merton Challenge.
Repetition, I just said all that. I mean, I just said all that. People flock all over the world. He's just copying what I've said.
No, I mean they flock to the Eurovision Song Contest.
Oh, I see. I withdraw my challenge.
No. All right. Paul, you've been on the show long enough now to know that you can repeat what someone else has said, as long as you don't repeat something within a round. All right. Peter, 21 seconds still available. Going for a song, starting now.
And they want to take part in it, of course, when they arrive. And many of them do, from Sweden, Norway, Ireland, all over the place. And they sing a number, which has been specially composed for the purpose, as a rule, and they are all, without exception, ghastly, in my opinion. Ireland often wins.
Well, fans of the show will be pleased to know that at the end of that round, Peter Jones not only got extra points on Speaking of the Whistle Went, but he's taken the lead ahead of
everyone. He's been in the lead before.
two ahead of Clement Freud. And, Paul, your turn to begin. The subject, Blockbusters. Will you tell us something about that subject in this game, starting now?
Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer, or if you prefer, MG, was perhaps the first film studio to initiate the huge musical blockbuster when talkies were invented sometime around 1928. They were the first studio to get hold of the new sound system and produce all singing...
Peter Jones, a challenge.
They were behind Warner Brothers.
Well, I was going to say the all-singing, all-dancing musical was very much an MGM thing.
Very much an MGM thing, but I tell you what we do. I don't know whether Warner Brothers pioneered it before MGM.
No, Warner Brothers certainly had the first sound film with Al Jolson.
Well, that was a musical, wasn't it?
Well, yes, it had musical numbers in it, but no dancing. It was sort of a big spectacular musical is what I was talking about.
Oh, I see.
Well, I think on that situation,
yes, well,
I can't really judge.
That seems reasonable to me.
Yeah, that was the point I was...
Very amicable. It. Give them both a point and leave the subject with Paul Merton, then. Paul, the 41 seconds are left for Blockbusters, starting now.
I was lying. It was Warner Brothers who started the whole big business of making these blockbuster musicals with Al Jolson.
Graham Norton challenge.
Was it a repetition of musicals?
Yes, that's right. That's right. Well done. Well listened, Graham. 34 seconds available. Blockbusters with you, Graham, starting now.
Blockbuster isn't a term you'd apply to Grimble at Christmas. A superb, slim volume written by Clement Freud, which brought me much pleasure in my childhood years. If it were a blockbuster, the front cover would have the title, that character at the holiday season, written in gold lettering, slightly raised off the page.
A Paul Merton challenge.
Repetition of written.
That's right. Written by Clement Freud. And written again came up. Paul's got in with 9 seconds to go on Blockbusters, starting now.
It used to be a rather irritating show hosted by Bob Holness, where spotty students would say things like, I'll have a pee, please, and then giggle.
Paul Merton speaking as the whistle went, gained that extra point. He has moved forward, just one ahead of Clement Freud, but he's still trailing our leader, Peter Jones. And Graham Norton, it's your turn to begin. The subject is The Twilight Zone. 60 seconds, starting now.
The Twilight Zone is a popular science fiction program emanating from America. One of the most popular episodes involved...
Clement Freud challenge.
Two populars.
There were two populars.
Right.
Yes, there are. So, Clement, a correct challenge. 53 seconds available. The Twilight Zone is starting now.
The Twilight Zone in London has telephones which are prefaced 0181. And we all feel really sorry for them. I subscribe to a charity which sends them food parcels and hopes that, like Captain Scott, they will come back and get better. The Twilight...
Graham Norton challenged.
Repetition of one.
Yes, you're quite right, Graham. Well, listen. There are 34 seconds for you on the Twilight Zone starting now.
As I was saying, my favourite...
Clement challenged her.
Deviation.
Why?
He's not sticking to the subject.
Oh, but like a leech. Like a leech. I want to go back.
I think we have to give him a little more time to get underway and establish whether he's on the subject or not. And I'd have thought, as I was saying, shows that he's really into the subject. Twilight Zone, with you, Graham, another point, 30 seconds starting now.
The Twilight Zone classic involved Captain Kirk, William Shatner, sitting in a plane. He looked through the window. There, on the wing, was something that looked very like a Edwina Curry attending a barbecue. He was terrified and rejected his in-flight meal. Fool, I thought, you'll want that later. But I didn't sleep hardly a wink that night. I tossed and turned. Such was the fever in my blood from the television. Oh.
Well, Graham Norton's surge of energy and expertise brought him extra points in that round, but he's still in fourth place. But that is just a minute, you see. It is the contribution which is so valuable. The points, I feel, are secondary. And, Clement, it is your turn to begin. The subject is vacuum. Will you tell us something about a vacuum or vacuum in just a minute, starting now?
Vacuum is one of the very few words that has a double U in it. It is also a cleaner, prefaced Hoover, one of the Many.
Merton challenged.
Well, was a slight hesitation, really?
It was a definite hesitation,
yes.
Graham.
Yes. Well, yeah.
Clement, you were challenged, and Graham Norton, you have the subject of vacuum. There are 49 seconds available, starting now.
I know what a vacuum is, because it was explained to me by Carol Vorderman, who is, coincidentally, my cleaning lady. Because you don't get paid a lot of money for doing sums, I'm here to tell you. So she was using this heavy piece of equipment, a vacuum. It makes a lot of noise. You need to drag it across your carpet. You sweat. You can't hear yourself think. The dog barks. Cat flees the room. The television's in bits. You can't watch a program. And yet...
Peter Jones has challenged.
Repetition of can't.
Can't. You can't do this and you can't do that.
Stop. Getting tired now.
You've got to... Just because he's playing to the audience outrageously doesn't mean to say that if he commits one of the sins of just a minute, he should get away with it. Peter, yes, he did emphasise it too. Vacuum is with you. 17 seconds available starting now.
It's a misnomer, really, vacuum cleaner, because you can't clean something that isn't there. And a vacuum is just nothing. Absolutely nothing.
Like Clement Freud challenge.
I think there were two nothings.
There were two nothings.
Yes, nothing.
Absolutely
yes.
Nothing, yes. Clement, you got him in 6 seconds on vacuum, starting now.
One of the very best ways to clean a carpet is to put pot ash onto it before engaging...
No, Peter challenged just before the whistle went.
Well, he's not... he's talking about cleaning now. Cleaning yes. A carpet. It has nothing to do with the word vacuum, necessarily.
Could have fooled me.
What? It's a debatable situation. I mean,
well,
you use a vacuum to clean a carpet. He'd only been going for 4 seconds. I think we'll give him the benefit of the doubt and say that he was speaking when the whistle went, so Clement Freud, you have that point, but you're still 1 point behind Peter Jones, who's still in the lead. We didn't get a round of applause when that happened. And Paul Merton, it's your turn to begin. The subject is the high life. Will you tell us something about your private life, if it's not the high life, but the high life if it is? And 60 seconds are available, starting now.
Balloonists are people who are said to enjoy the high life. There is nothing that would get me up into a hot air balloon. The idea of standing in this wicker basket while you're some 650 feet up in the air, and there's nothing between you and the ground apart from this aforementioned thing that you'd normally keep your laundry in at home, but there, suddenly, it's between you and the bottom of where you're going, looking down. That's right. And that's what I don't like about it. And the other thing about the high life, which I...
Peter Jones challenge.
Repetition of about.
Oh, Peter, you've got this little bee in your bonnet about ands and ors and ever since
about
you...
About is two syllables.
Oh, all right.
It's the big time.
Right, Peter, it's going to be the preposition show this time, and you've challenged again on that. But it was successful, it was correct. Your high life is with you. 33 seconds are available, starting now.
A lot of people in aircraft practice the high life, and they have badges.
Clement Freud challenge.
Hesitation.
You were thinking of the high flying club, were you? And it made you pause.
The what?
The high fly... What's it called? The high... A high... What's it again? The Fly High Club.
No. What is it called? The Deaf Club?
The Mile High Club, it's called. You see, I'm almost Peter's age, and we were searching for the same thing, but we...
Indeed.
At our age, we have to search for it.
Any luck?
What's that?
Any luck?
frequently, yes.
You amaze me.
Really? Mile high all the time. Right. Clement, there are 27 seconds for you on the Mile High Club. Oh, I'm so sorry. 27 seconds on the high life starting now.
People have different concepts of high life. For me, it would be having a season ticket at home park and watching Plymouth Argyle win all their matches in the third division, week upon month after year. And they now play in green and white and black, which they think is a higher...
Paul Merton challenge.
Well, as we had it before, repetition of and. Green and white and black.
Yes, you're quite right. We're going to have these prepositions.
I didn't start it.
I didn't start it. This is, I say, going to be the preposition show. 9 seconds are available, Paul. The High Life, starting now.
I remember a film called The High Life that featured this wonderful country and western musical moment called The Preposition Bound, where these two cowboys rode across this town that was...
Paul Merton, speaking as the Whistle Wind, gained that extra point, has moved forward. He's now equal, once again, with Peter Jones in the lead, but only 1 point behind is Clement Freud, and then another point or two behind is Graham Norton. Graham Norton, it's your turn to begin. The subject is Paris. Will you tell us something about that? Does that bring back thoughts of ecstasy that you were beguiling us with earlier on?
No.
Right. Paris is the subject, Graham, starting now.
If there is a mental hospital in Paris, I wish someone would tell the mad people where it is. Because you can scarcely relax on a terrace, munching on a baguette, perhaps formed into a sandwich of some sort, ham, cheese, lettuce. But lo and behold, there's some yee-haw yip howling at the moon, crazy creature at your table. And what's more, though they are a bit touched up top, they can speak French. And on they go. But of course, because they are just a little bit below what you might expect of another human being you meet in the street, they think you can talk their language as well. This can lead to difficulties. Paris, of course, is reached via the...
Clement Freud challenge.
Two of courses.
Yeah.
No. Fair.
I know, but you've been going for 57 seconds.
Clement, I think you've lost the crowd now.
Definitely he has. You've done all the hard work. You've got all the emotional response of that audience. And Clement gets in with 3 seconds to go. 1 point for that, Clement. Paris starting now.
I entered a competition, What is the Capital City of France?
There's no justice in Just a Minute, so Graham did all the hard work and kept going, made a great contribution, and Clement came in and got 2 points. And it now remains for me to give you the final score, because we have no more time this week to play Just a Minute. You've enjoyed it, have you? In this particular show, Graham Norton, who came from nowhere and gave incredible value, and his value was such that you were thoroughly enjoyed it, but he didn't get a lot of points. But that is Just a Minute, alas. So he's in fourth place. Then Clement Freud, who always gives great value, but he finished up with fewer points than usual. And Peter Jones, who always gives great value, finished up with a lot of points. But he didn't quite get as much points as a man who also gives great value. And he was just 2 points ahead. So we say this week the winner is Paul Merton. We do hope that you have enjoyed this edition of Just a Minute. And it only remains for me to thank our four talented and outstanding players of the game, Clement Freud, Graham Norton, Paul Merton, Peter Jones. Also thank Elaine Wigley for keeping the score, blowing her whistle so delicately and admirably when the 60 seconds were up. Also, we must thank the creator of the game, Ian Messiter, without whom none of us would be doing the show, and also our producer, Anne Jobson, who does such an admirable job. And on behalf of them all and me, thank you and goodbye. Welcome to Just a Minute. Hello,
Hello, my name is Nicholas Parsons, and as the minute waltz fades away, once more it is my pleasure not only to welcome the listeners to the programme, but also to welcome to the show the four exciting and dynamic personalities who are going to play the game this week. We welcome back two of the original players of the game who have been with us for many years and still playing with great aplomb. That is Clement Freud and Peter Jones, and two of the younger generation of comedians who have shown such skill in just a minute. That is Tony Hawks and Fred McCauley. Would you please welcome all four of them? And this particular recording of Just a Minute comes from the Students' Union in the ancient Scottish University of St. Andrews. And we have an audience in front of us who are looking so excited. Undergraduates, graduates, profs, doctors, lecturers. Absolutely everyone is here in the audience waiting to hear Just a Minute again. Elaine Wigley sits beside me. She has a stopwatch. She has a whistle. She's going to keep the score and blow that whistle when 60 seconds is up. And I'm going to ask our four talented panelists to speak, if they can, on the subject that I give them. And, of course, they have to try and do that without hesitation, repetition, or deviating from the subject. And this week we're going to begin the show with Tony Hawks. Tony Greens. That's the subject. Can you talk about greens in Just a Minute, starting now?
A few weeks back, I was told a very unsavoury joke by a small child on the subject of greens, which I think perhaps I'll share with you, although maybe I shouldn't. It's, what's the difference between broccoli and bogies? You can't get children to eat broccoli. Now, this is most...
Fred McCauley challenge.
A repetition of the word broccoli.
Those are the rules of Just a Minute. You can't repeat words. That's why it's so difficult to keep going. But, Fred, you challenge. It's a correct challenge. You get a point for a correct challenge, and you take over the subject of greens, and there are 41 seconds left, starting now.
There may be 41 seconds left, Nicholas, but there are 18 famous greens here in St. Andrews, and what a fine place it is. Famous for...
Oh, Clement challenge.
Repetition of famous.
There was too much famous, and it is famous, yes. And 32 seconds available for you, Clement Freud, having gained a point for a correct challenge, to talk on greens, starting now.
I could have said cabbage, kale, spinach, peas, beans, broccoli, asparagus, but as we are in St. Andrews, which is a great centre of golf, I thought I would talk about the greens here and...
Peter Jones' challenge.
Hesitation.
Yes, indeed. So we hear from everybody in the first round. Isn't that exciting? Peter, 16 seconds are available. The subject's with you, having gained a point for a correct challenge. Greens, starting now.
The Americans have gone to great trouble to try to persuade children to eat greens, namely spinach. And they invented this character called Popeye and his androgynous girlfriend, Olive Oil.
Oh, Tony and got in just before you got her name out.
I just wanted to know how you were spelling that.
O-L-I-V-E-O-I-L.
And
I, there's no obligation to spell it, is there?
Absolutely not. 3 seconds are available for you, Tony, having got the subject back. Greens, starting now.
Honestly, what a family the Greens were. I wish they'd never moved in there.
Tony Hawks was then speaking as the whistle went, and whoever does that in this game gains an extra point. So he's in the lead at the end of the round. Everybody else is equal in second place. Peter Jones, the next round is a fence. That's the subject. Would you take it, please, and start now?
A fence is like Fagin, a man who buys stolen property and sells it at a great profit. And if you see anybody doing this, I suggest that you try to stop them using whatever means you can. Sit on them, if you like. Sitting on a fence is a kind of a citizen's arrest, and it is the best thing to do if you catch them at it.
Clement, you challenge first. Yes, hesitation. We interpret that as 31 seconds, a fence starting now.
At entry, where the Grand National is run every year, there are a number of fences which have endearing names like the first, second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth. Ninth.
Tony challenged.
Well, he's talking about lots of fences here, rather than a fence.
And I think Beecher's came before the 8th or the 9th, so in sequence I don't think it was actually correct. But so, Tony, a correct challenge. 13 seconds starting now.
I don't know whether any of you are interested here in the audience tonight, but I have 300 video recorders backstage, which I am trying to shift, which Peter Jones handed over to me earlier.
Tony Hawks was again speaking as the whistle went, gained an extra point for doing so, and has increased his lead at the end of the round. Fred McCauley, will you take the next round? The subject, friends. Tell us something about friends in just a minute, starting now.
Well, it used to be that you could talk about friends and people assumed you were mentioning your amigos or your buddies or your close pals. But ever since the arrival in these shores of the sitcom, you can't mention the word without people saying, who do you fancy most? Is it Monica or Rachel? Maybe it's Phoebe, the ditzy blonde one. And of course, for people who are attracted to the male of the species, there's Tony, the dim but handsome one. Chandler, who I assume is everybody's favourite. And of course, the learned...
Clement Freud challenge.
Repetition of course.
Yes, I'm afraid you did say of course before.
That's all right.
All right. It's in the rules, right? 30 seconds. Clement, you have friends starting now.
Nicholas Parsons recently had his 50th anniversary in show business. And a number of his friends turned up. Actually, quite few, but they all appeared in Hello magazine some weeks after the occasion. And I remember seeing pictures of Mrs. Chairman.
Fred McCauley challenge.
There was a hesitation.
There was a hesitation, yes. 5 seconds, Fred, on friends starting now.
Well, I count myself as a very lucky man because I've got friends like Tony Hawks who has asked me on many an occasion...
Clement, your turn to begin. The subject is porter. 60 seconds as usual, starting now.
A porter is someone who carries your bags, usually for money. And they are sometimes called porter. And they drink porter, which is a sort of darkish beer, quite often created by putting a red-hot poker into ale and giving it a hue as well as a smell which is indicative of the action taken by brewers to create porter.
Peter Jones's challenge.
I'm surprised. He's quite wrong about it making something into porter, putting a poker in it. Porter is brewed like beer with malt and hops and so on, and it's rich and very nourishing.
Have you tried putting a poker into it?
Peter, I would incline to... Your culinary knowledge convinces me that you deserve the point and the subject, and there are 32 seconds, Peter, starting now.
If you've ever seen that wonderful play, The Barrett of Wimpole Street, you may remember a scene in which the father, Barrett, tries to persuade his daughter, Norma Shearer...
Freud has challenged you.
Two Barretts.
There were two Barretts, I'm afraid, yes.
Yes, there were. Yes. There were a lot of Barretts at, Wimpole Street.
Yeah, that's right. Porter is back with you. 21 seconds available, Clement, starting now.
At London Airport, they now have porters who carry messages stating...
Tony Hawk's challenge.
A repetition of carry from the first time you were talking.
Carrying, I said the first time.
Oh! I tell you what, as I can't actually judge on this one, I now turn...
Why can't you judge?
To the superior wisdom of this audience, St. Andrews, which I love to do. So I would like you to be the final judge. Did he say carrying or carry before? If you agree with Tony Hawks, you cheer for him. And if you disagree, you boo for Clement Freud. And you all do it together now. Thank you for listening so well. Tony, you have 15 seconds on porter starting now.
If a porter isn't working hard enough on your behalf, you can always threaten him with a red-hot poker. This always does the trick in my experience. They must be very miffed at the way at airports now they have these free trolleys.
Peter Jones challenged.
You can't just pick up a red-hot poker.
Huh? really have got a real thing about red hot pokers, haven't you, Peter?
Well, I haven't. I don't keep bringing them up. Other people are bringing them up all
so
the time.
So what you're saying is deviation because you can't pick up a red hot poker?
Yes.
If the handle is sufficiently desensitized, you can pick it up. Why else do you think? I mean, if you work in a foundry, they have some red hot pokers.
No, but you can't pick one up because it's not there. They don't have red hot pokers all over the place that keep growing.
If we can't use suppositional fantasy in just a minute, I think we've had it. So, Peter, I have to disagree with the challenge. The benefit
you
of
think
the doubt...
you can find these pokers?
I don't think it would just be the end of the poker that would be desensitized either, would it?
Right. Tony, benefit of the doubt. 2 seconds, Porter, starting now.
Nairi Dawn Porter was in the Foresight Saga. I used to work...
Right. Tony Hawks has increased his lead at the end of that round. The others are almost equal together in second place. And now we have a very golf-type subject, a niblick. And Tony... It's not erotic, I do assure you. Tony, it's your turn to begin, so will you tell us something about a niblick starting now?
If you wander into the hallowed clubhouse of the Royal and Ancient Golf Club here in St. Andrews, hanging on the wall, there is a niblick. Ralph Niblick, his name is, and he was hung there for not wearing a tie in the bar. It is, of course, I jest, an old wooden club used mainly for getting out of bunkers. Herr Hitler...
Clement Freud challenge.
Deviation.
Why?
Is used for getting balls out of bunkers.
I think it's a subtle challenge, but we have to give you the benefit of the doubt. Clement, 30 seconds, a niblick starting now.
A niblick was once called a blinky, an anagram of niblick, because of the speed with which the ball was hit out of a blanker.
You can't hit a ball out of a blanker. A blanker has balls all round it.
Yes, it is a little deviant from the knowledge of golf that I possess. So, back with you, Tony. A niblick, 18 seconds, starting now.
I have a trusty old niblick. I intend to use it tomorrow when I shall play golf with Fred McCauley on the old course. I will get it out on the fifth hole, I know, and beat him round the head with it. Because, frankly, they're useless clubs made of a substance which will not propel a ball...
And you will see a few niblicks in the Royal and Ancient if you go and look there. Yes, they did actually use them, and they did get round the course of them. And Tony Hawks, you kept going with the subject till the whistle went, gained that extra point, and you have increased your lead at the end of the round. Peter Jones, your turn to begin. A blue stocking. Tell us something about that in just a minute, starting now.
Oh, it's a phrase used to describe women, girls very often, who used to study to the exclusion of not much else. Now, one blue stocking, of course, doesn't make a pair. And I suppose if one wore one blue stocking, it would be someone who was sort of half interested in studying. I don't know. When I was a boy, about 8 years old, I lived next door to a family who had a daughter of about my age. And once she called me into the sitting room there when her parents were out, and she revealed that she was interested in something called romance, which I didn't actually know what she meant. I hadn't ever heard the word, probably, because my parents didn't get on all that well, and they didn't ever use that word.
They were all agog. They want you to get to the nitty-gritty of that story, Andy.
Well, I know.
Anyway, Peter, yes. A point for speaking as the whistle went. Other points in the round. You're 9th, 3rd place, just behind Clement Freud, but Tony Hawks is still our leader. Fred McCauley, it's your turn to begin. The subject is the old course, which you mentioned earlier, but tell us something about it in this game, starting now.
Yeah, Tony mentioned that we're going to be playing golf there tomorrow, which comes as a bit of a surprise to me because I brought my basketball boots. But never mind. I'll try and avoid him and his niblick as we walk down the fifth, which, as you know, is one of the many holes there, 18 to be precise. There's the burn, followed by the dyke, if I remember correctly, cart gate, then, of course, the curiously named ginger beer, which came as a surprise and a shock to the large American golfer John Daly, recovering alcoholic, when he played there and won the Open Championship in 1995. Then there are 6, 7, 8, which have got curious names, but none so odd.
Clement Freud challenge, yes. What is a challenge?
I thought there was a hesitation.
Yes, there was a hesitation, Clement. So tell us something about the old course, this famous, the most famous golf course in the world. 20 seconds are still available, starting now.
One always wonders when a place was called the old course, because having been built, it must have been the new course. And over the years, I suppose, people have said, where are Fred and Tony going to play? And they say, the old course, I should think.
Tony Hawks, you're still in the lead. Clement Freud is in second place. Then Peter Jones, then Fred McCauley. And Clement, your turn to begin. Seventh heaven. Some find it on the old course. Some find it in St. Andrews. Where do you find it, Clement? 60 seconds, starting now.
Seventh heaven is pretty low down in heavens. I mean, the first heaven has got 3 Michelin stars, is absolutely brilliant. When you get to the seventh heaven, I doubt there'll be much more than a buffet and a sweet trolley. I have no intention of going down as far the line as seven, so let us think where one would go beyond. Is there an eighth heaven? If there is, I haven't heard of one. What would you get there, and when does it become hell? These and many other questions I would like to leave to my colleagues in this game, who only have to press their buttons in order to persuade me to stop this.
Tony, you have a challenge. What is it?
Everything stopped, and I thought...
Which we interpret as hesitation.
Yeah.
Seventh heaven is with you. 12 seconds are available, starting now.
Presumably, Peter Jones was in seventh heaven, as a young 8-year-old, he was invited into his neighbour's house, where romance began. What a marvellous opportunity to him to discover at this early age...
Tony Hawks, again speaking as a whistle wind, gained that extra point and has increased his lead, and he also takes the next round. And the subject, Tony, is rectors. Very apt for here. 60 seconds as usual, starting now.
Any further educational establishment worth its salt should have a prestigious figure as its rector. Why, then, should a seat of learning like St. Andrew's University...
Peter Jones, a challenge.
How do you spell... prestigious.
Any other challenge within the rules of just a minute?
No, but he asked me to spell something.
He asked you to spell androgynous, which we can't, prestigious. So, Peter, they enjoyed the challenge. You got a round of applause for it, so we give
really?
You a bonus point for your remarks, but Tony was interrupted, so he gets a point for being interrupted. Keeps the subject rectors with you, Tony, starting now.
Why, then, did they choose Nicholas Parsons as theirs? What kind of drugs are they on? And as far as...
Fred McCauley, Charles.
There was a bit of a stumble there. I'm going to claim a hesitation.
It doesn't matter what he said, you'd have it in anyway.
Yeah.
Right, 38 seconds, Fred. Rector, starting now.
I'm wholly in agreement with Tony that learned places of education should have outstanding rectors. I was fortunate enough to be at Dundee University, and the rector at that time was none other than Clement I'm in awe of being in his presence again and seem to have got away with that little fluff. I don't think anybody...
You've been challenged, actually.
Oh, what was
that? You're challenged. Clement, your challenge.
Fluff.
A fluff, yes. A deviation from the name as we understand it. So, Clement, a correct challenge. 24 seconds on rectors starting now.
When I was elected rector of Dundee University, the secretary approached me and said, "We are extremely pleased that it was you who was selected." And I said, "Why?" And he replied that I was the only one who would fit into Peter Ustinov's gown. He had been my predecessor, and it saved them purchasing new clothing for this high office.
So, Clement Freud kept going to the whistle when gained the extra point. He's still in second place behind our leader, Tony Hawkes, and Fred McCauley's turn to begin. Fred, the subject is Scrabble. Tell us something about that in just a minute, please, starting now.
Well, I've gone on record in the past as saying that the only decent thing you can mention about the Welsh language is if you're playing Scrabble and you've got seven consonants, you're laughing. L-P-G-W-D-S-V is a word pronounced... translates into English as, "Forgive me, I have a viral infection." And it's worth about 37 points. And I don't think there is anybody more boring on God's earth than these Scrabble freaks that can tell you what the points value is of every word you utter to them. You know the type.
Peter Jones has challenged.
I've known golf players who are pretty close.
Repetition of points as well. Points.
Points.
Yeah, so, yeah, I like that, I like that. Get a bonus point for Peter for that particular round of applause. And you challenging on what? On the repetition?
Well, conceit, really.
He did repeat points.
Yes, he did.
Yes, that's right. Well done, Peter. So you have a... You also have a point for a correct challenge and 29 seconds for you on Scrabble starting now.
Yes, it's a pretty boring game, in my opinion, but it can be played on aircraft when you're not able, really, to play cards satisfactorily. And if you like crossword puzzles, which I don't much, then you are probably very well into Scrabble. The word, of course, can also be used to describe scrabbling, which is a kind of...
Fred challenged.
Yes, a hesitation there.
A hesitation, a very strong more than one, actually. Fred, you got back in on Scrabble with 4 seconds to go, starting now.
I always feel as though I've cheated a bit if I use the blank square in Scrabble. But
Clement Freud challenge.
Repetition of square.
Yes, you talked about squares before, I'm afraid. Oh. And Clement's got in with only half a second to go on Scrabble, Clement, starting now.
Q.
So, a lot of points were scored in that round, but as we approach the last round of the contest, Tony Hawkes is still in the lead. Just 2 points ahead of Clement Freud, 1 point ahead of Peter Jones, that's Clement, and a few points behind is Fred McCauley. And Clement, it's your turn to begin. Trifles is a subject, Clement, 60 seconds as usual, starting now.
A trifle, which the French call le trifle, is a sort of pudding which can contain... almost anything, usually cake, alcohol, jam, custard, cream, hundreds of thousands.
Peter Jones has challenged.
Well, it can't contain almost anything. It's not. It's an exaggeration.
You couldn't put a red-hot poker into it. No, logically, Peter...
Even a shin of beef wouldn't go too well, either.
You're quite right. Logically, it could not contain anything, so a correct challenge to you. 44 seconds available to tell us something about trifles starting now.
But if you use as a base some sponge cakes and a lot of sherry or some similar liqueur, and you add fruit that is available in the house, sometimes raspberry jam, that adds a lot to it, and a few split almonds, it can be a very nice dish topped with thick whipped cream. It's not exactly on a sort of diet. It's not. It's got a lot of cholesterol.
Tony Hawkes has challenged.
Well, of course it's not on a diet. It's a pudding.
Tony, another point to you and 19 seconds to tell us something about trifles starting now.
My step-grandmother used to make the most magnificent trifles. She'd bring them down in the morning because she'd make them at night, God knows why, and she'd say, "Tony, look what I've made you." I'd say, "It's a trifle." She'd say, "Yes, nothing much gets..."
Fred McCauley challenge.
A repetition of the word "see."
Yes, well done, Fred. So, on the last round, like the first, we're hearing from everybody. Isn't that nice? 7 seconds for Trifle with you, Fred Macaulay, starting now.
Trifles is worth 37...
Clement Freud chance.
Deviation.
What?
Trifles is.
Well, if you'd like let me finish the sentence...
I don't like trifles is.
Well, I'm going to...
Justify yourself.
I was going to say trifles is worth 37 points on a Scrabble board.
So, Fred, you get a point for being interrupted and a point for your justification, which the audience enjoyed. Clement, you challenged again.
Is not worth 37 points.
But he didn't say that in just a minute. He was justifying it outside the context.
It depends where you put it as well, doesn't it?
That's right. I was counting a triple letter score on the F.
Fred, 4 seconds to continue, starting now.
I remember well my school days and the lunches that we used to have in the...
So Fred Macaulay speaking as the whistle went, gained that extra point for doing so, gained a large number of points in that game. He's only played the game 3 times before, so his contribution was marvellous. He came from lying nowhere, actually, and with that last flourish, he leapt forward to be alongside Peter Jones and Clement Freud in second place. Just 3 points ahead was Tony Hawk. So, Tony, with the most points, we say, you're the winner this week. So... it only remains for me to thank our 4 intrepid players of the game for their delightful and interesting contributions, Clement Freud, Tony Hawkes, Peter Jones, and Fred Macaulay. We do thank this wonderful animated student audience here at this wonderful University of St. Andrews. Thank you for coming. Beside me, I must thank Elaine Wigley for the way she kept the score and blew her whistle. We must thank Ian Messiter, who created the game. Anne Jobson produces and directs, and we are deeply grateful to her. But from all of us here... to our listeners, without whom we would not be in work, thank you for tuning in. Be with us the next time we take to the air and we play Just a Minute. Until then, goodbye. Welcome to Just a Minute. Hello, my name is Nicholas Parsons, and as the minute waltz fades away, once more it is my pleasure to welcome not only our listeners, but also the 4 exciting and dynamic entertainers who this week are going to play Just a Minute. We welcome 2 young comedians who've shown such outstanding ability, one of them in this particular show, that is Paul Merton, and Julian Clary, who's only played the game once before. And with them, we have 2 of the oldest players of the game. They've been with it since the show first began, contributed so well we can't let them go. They are Derek Nimmo and Clement Freud, but would you please welcome all 4 of them? So sitting beside me is Elaine Wigley with a stopwatch to let me know how the seconds are ticking away, and when 60 seconds have passed, she will blow a whistle to let us know the end of that round. And this particular recording of Just a Minute is coming from the Jersey Arts Centre in St Helier, the capital of this lovely island, during their magnificent festival. I understand there are more people of wealth who live in Jersey, and yet we've never had such a big queue for the free seats. Let us begin the show this week with Paul Merton, and Paul, the subject apt for Jersey, I'm sure, cows. Can you tell us something about cows in Just a Minute, starting now?
There is no one thing more wonderful than a Jersey cow. Absolutely brilliant animal. It has a head, it has four legs that support the body, a tail at the back, and it's not mad, unlike most of the cows that we have in Great Britain. I've been here for a short time. I have seen no cows riding motorbikes. I have not seen a heifer driving a minicab. This is surely concrete proof that these are the sanest cows in the world. Why, the Jersey cow lives on a diet of potatoes.
A Derek Nimmo challenge.
Repetition of Jersey.
Yes, because the cow's on the subject. But well done. You know how to win friends and influence people. Yes. Whoever challenges and has a correct challenge gains a point. On this occasion, it was Derek Nimmo, and so he takes over the subject. There are 29 seconds available for cows, starting now.
Hey, diddle, diddle, a cat on the fiddle, the cow jumped
Clement
over
Freud,
the...
What's the challenge? Matter? Diddle, diddle. As you've played the game so often, Derek, I have to give it against you, but that is the problem of Just a Minute. Clement, a correct challenge, 26 seconds, cows starting now.
It is sort of unusual to be sitting in the Arts Centre at St Helier on the island of Jersey and talk about cows, which is such a very amenable seaport in White, Hampshire.
Julian Clary challenge.
I thought he was fumbling and hesitating.
I think he was sort of running down a bit. Julian, I'm going to give you the benefit of the doubt. I'll find a way to give the benefit of the doubt to Clement later. Cows is with you, Julian. 13 seconds, starting now. And Clement for a challenge.
I'd like the benefit of the doubt.
You very cleverly got it back again, Clement. So a point to Julian, a point to Clement. 12 seconds are left on cows with you, Clement, starting now.
At Portsmouth, you get onto a ferry, and within about 25 minutes, you arrive at cows, where awfully nice people from Avon welcome you and lead you to their chips and butties.
That whistle tells us that 60 seconds are up, and whoever is speaking at that moment gains an extra point. On this occasion, it was Clement Freud, so he is in the lead at the end of the first round. Derek, will you take the next round? The subject, farce. Will you tell us something about farce? You're a great exponent of it, I know. Talk on it, please. 60 seconds, starting now.
Farce is a kind of popular comedy which often involves a deal of horseplay and physical humour. If it descends too much in that direction, it becomes burlesque and has no truth, which farce really should have. I suppose the first plays written for farce purely were in France in the 14th and 15th century. This was taken up by the British cathedrals, and it's interesting to know that the first comic character in British history was Mrs. Noah.
Paul challenged.
A repetition of British, I'm afraid.
Yes, and first. And first. So, yes. Mm-hmm. So 31 seconds, Paul, a correct challenge. You take over the subject. Farce, starting now.
I believe it is a very difficult art form to write and act and direct, produce, that kind of thing.
Clement, you challenge. Yes.
I got
that
bored.
Sort of thing.
Another point for a correct challenge, and 22 seconds left for farce with you, Clement, starting now.
Farce is what the French call stuffing. You put it inside a chicken or a piece of meat. Onion, shallot, garlic.
Paul challenged.
Hesitation?
I think he was riding the laugh, but, I mean, it's awfully difficult. I was very harsh with him a little while ago. I don't think I should be so harsh this time. So that's been the benefit of the doubt. 14 seconds, still with you, Clement. Farce, starting now.
Any sort of herb or spice is useful for farce. I would go for...
Julian Clary challenge.
I don't know what he's talking about. What does he mean?
It's the stuffing you put into animals when you're cooking them.
Called farce? Mm. Oh, isn't it educational? What you thought? I want to know more about your
lovely
stuffing.
So you'd like him to continue. 7 seconds, Clement, on farce, starting now.
A farce is also the name given to a comedy in which people drop their...
A Derek Nimmo challenge.
Repetition of name. Name the French.
Yeah, that's right, the name the French give. I'm sorry, Clement, against you on this occasion. 3 seconds. Well, listen, Derek, farce, starting now.
Cash on Delivery is the latest Cooney farce, which is opened at the Whitehall Theatre.
Derek Nimmo with us then speaking as the whistle went, gained that extra point for doing so. He's now in second place. Clement Freud is in a strong lead. Julian Clary follows, and it is his turn to begin, and the subject is, Julian, dealing with a crisis. Can you tell us something about that subject in this game starting now?
The best way to deal with a crisis is to ask a policeman. I recently had trouble with my big end on the M25. I simply stuck my arm out and along came a policeman. I said, could you have a look for me?
Derek, give me a challenge.
Sorry, repetition of policemen.
Yes.
The well, there were two of them.
Mm. Oh, I see.
47 seconds with you, Derek. Dealing with a crisis.
I was faced with a crisis very early on in life when my Wendy house got a direct hit from an incendiary bomb in 1942. I rushed out and with my sister we grabbed hold of a stirrup pump and a bucket of water and we turned to this little hut which was now in blazing fire and squirted water at it until finally it was extinguished.
Oh, challenge.
There was a hesitation.
There wasn't.
That was drama, don't you understand? Very dramatic moment.
That is part.
That you've never seen your Wendy house go up in flames. You know what it was like.
That is part of the challenge of Just a Minute, yes. You can't pause for drama and you can't pause when you have a laugh because you have to ride your way through it. Paul, I agree with the challenge. 26 seconds. Dealing with a crisis, starting now.
So there I was, up to me neck in muck and bullets, when suddenly I realised an earthquake was coming my way. Already the hotel was underwater because it had fallen off the cliff into the sea earlier, which was lucky because it had put out the fire that had been going in the foyer. So as the earthquake took hold, suddenly...
Derek, your challenge, please.
Two earthquakes.
Yes, there were.
Sorry.
9 seconds, Derek. Dealing with a crisis, starting now.
I took my granddaughter and grandson out last week for a friend's house for lunch, and a little boy went up to the...
Clement Freud challenge.
Repetition of house.
House.
He had a Wendy house before.
You had a Wendy house.
Wendy house, was it?
No, it's two words. Two words.
Wendy house is hyphenated.
They'll try anything, won't they? Clement, I agree with your challenge. 3 seconds are left. Dealing with a crisis, starting now.
The very best way to deal with a crisis is very gently.
Clement, you have got more points for speaking as a whistle. Went, well, I say a point, but you have more points in the round, and you have increased your lead over Derek Nimmo, who's in second place, and it's also your turn to begin. The subject is crops. 60 seconds. Crops. Clement, starting now.
I would like to begin by speaking about the rotation of crops, but feel that this might be repetitious, and therefore wheat, maize, rye, fruit... Rice. Now, there's very little of the latter crop on these islands because it doesn't rain enough. But if you had such a substance and it came from the paddy fields in the region of St. Clements, I do recommend that you cook it with the utmost care. Begin with butter, margarine or olive oil.
Poor challenge.
Well, this is a recipe now, isn't it?
Yes. Deviating from crops. 26 seconds for you on crops, Paul, starting now.
Crop circles have made a bit of an impact in the last 5 years in the British countryside. And you see these patterns of in the wheat, which looks like something from outer space has created a marvellous geometric shape. Actually, what it is, it's two old men and a plank and a bit of wood and a cat that doesn't know any better that go out every Saturday night and actually flatten the farmer's field as far as the eye can see.
Yeah. Paul Merton kept going to the Whistwimpt. He's still in third place behind Derek Nimmo, who was behind our leader, Clement Freud. And if you wonder why the laugh occurred when he first started speaking, then it was because Clement tried to inhibit him by staring down his neck. Paul, it is your turn to begin. The subject is monsters. 60 seconds as usual, starting now.
I was watching a film on Channel 4 the other night, Son of Frankenstein, made in 1939. A wonderful movie in many ways, and I enjoy watching these theatrical releases from long ago because quite often there's a very funny line which I find amusing but is clearly meant to be dramatic. And in the film I mentioned earlier, the one-armed policeman turns to...
Julian Clary's...
We had two films.
Oh, yeah.
Yes. Well, listen, Julian. Julian, you have a correct challenge, a point, of course. 38 seconds are available on monsters, starting now.
There's some awfully ugly creatures that live deep down in the sea. And if you go out on a boat far off into the horizon and you stick your rod out and reel out the line, who knows what you might pull in? And you'll hold it up to the line and you'll think, oh, well, I don't like the look of that. That's monstrous, you'll say to yourself. So you'll throw it over your shoulder and you'll try again. Maybe next time it won't be quite so monstrous. That's the moral of this.
Derek.
Sorry, repetition of monstrous.
Maybe. Yes. 11 seconds, Derek, on monster, starting now.
Robert Maxwell, used to...
challenged.
Hesitation.
Yes, for once, you didn't start rapidly. Strange for you, you usually start before I say no. Paul. Correct challenge. Monster, starting now.
If you can remember what I was saying earlier, the policeman then says one does not easily forget an arm torn off by the root hair Frankenstein. To which the doctor then says, more brand.
So Paul Merton with his monsters has moved forward. He's equal with Derek Nimmo in second place, just behind our leader, who's still Clement Freud. Julian follows, and Derek's turn to begin. Derek, a haven. Will you tell us something about that subject in this game, starting now?
Well, that does seem to be a singularly appropriate subject, being in Jersey, which is one of the more attractive havens for financial management in the whole wide world. There are safe places, supposedly like the Cayman Islands, but who would want to go to Liberia? No, I would suggest and recommend, indeed.
Julian Charles.
What's the matter?
Were you hesitating and fumbling?
Both my hands are on the table.
So, Julian, what do you think the challenge was?
Hesitate.
Hesitate. You thought he was hesitating?
I thought so, but I might be wrong.
I think you were, actually, yes. Derek, 39 seconds still available on a haven, starting now.
60 banks exist on this isle. There's a Standard Chartered, Hong Kong and Shanghai, National Westminster, Barclays. What's the matter? Why they are here?
Clement.
Deviation.
You got off the banks and so forth. So, Clement, a correct challenge. 27 seconds are available for a haven, starting now.
One of the most interesting things about a tax haven is the number of banks which you have to have in order to accommodate those people who use your island for the purpose described. Panama is that.
Julian Clary, challenge.
He's deviating now, going on about banks.
Yes, he's talking more about banks than a haven, yes.
Yes.
14 seconds are available. A haven starting now.
The most beautiful haven I've ever been to is the Maldives Islands, where there are no banks whatsoever. It's beautiful.
Derek Nimmo, challenge.
There's a branch of Barclays there.
Well, as I haven't yet been to the Maldives, and I can't vouch for that fact, Julian, I'm going to give you the benefit of the doubt, and 7 seconds for Julian Clary to continue on a haven starting now.
There are snowy white beaches and palm trees and the occasional coconut will fall.
Plop. Tell the challenge.
He's talking about beaches and coconuts, not havens.
I think the picture of beaches with coconuts conjures up to my mind a most idyllic... And so, Julian...
Not banks, no. Beaches.
How can a beach be a haven?
Well, to some people, a bank on a beach would be a haven.
I think an escapist attitude is what we're looking for in a haven, and that's what Julian was conveying to my mind. And he's another point, and he has half a second on a haven, starting now.
Fishly.
So Julian's Haven kept in going to the whistle when gained an extra point for doing so. He also gained a number of points in the round, and he is now in second place. Only one behind Clement Freud, but it's a very even contest because Derek Nimmo and Paul Merton are only 1 point behind him, equal in third place. And Julian, it is your turn to begin. The subject is skiving. Would you tell us something about that subject in this game, if you can, starting now?
Skiving has several meanings. It is, of course, a way of avoiding doing your duty. One or two people have skived out of the theatre in the last 10 minutes. It's also a sexual practice, which you may not have heard of. It involves a packet of straws, 6 stamps, and a skipful of Marmite. I can't, on Radio 4, go into details, but it's very good for the circulation. And if you do it often enough during your youth, then you'll grow up big and strong. Look at me. Clement, I'm big and strong, and I've been...
Derek Nimmo challenge.
He's been big and strong twice. Hello.
But it was deviation within the rules of just a minute, but you did keep going for 40 seconds. Well done, Julian. Derek has got the subject. 20 seconds are available. Skiving starting
Skiving
now.
Can mean to avoid proper work. I'll tell you a case in point, and that's that Anton Mossman who advertises Jersey Royals. I never see anybody do so little work for absolutely nothing at all, just picks them up and chats about them. That, to me, is skiving. The man's as rich as Croesus anyway. Why does he have to have those little spuds in his hand? Can't you find a more likely figure to advertise his awful thing?
So, Derek Nimmo's passionate denunciation of skiving made him move forward until the whistle went, gained that extra point for doing so, and he's now equal with Clement Freud in the lead, but closely followed by Julian Clary and Paul Merton in that order. And Clement, your turn to begin. The subject, Jersey Lily. 60 seconds starting now.
Jersey Lily was the name by which Mrs. Langtry was known in England, which is quite absurd because she came from Guernsey, which I think everybody knows. Nevertheless, Jersey Lily it was, and Edward VII had an absolutely rotten time trying to justify the relationship, especially in the light of Jersey Lily's husband, who lost in turn his wife, his money, and his reputation. And went whence we do not know whither, I should have said. Jersey Lily is the sort of subject on which you long to be interrupted.
Paul Merton, challenge.
Clement's dream has come true.
So that was deviation, talking about being interrupted and not talking about Jersey Lily. So, Paul, you have the subject of Jersey Lily, and there are 21 seconds left starting now.
Well, as Clement said, she was the mistress of Edward VII, and he used to specialise in getting in and out of musicals around the back way. There's a place in Islington where there's a pine shop opposite the road from where there used to be a big, big variety fair.
Clement, you challenged on the big, big.
Big, big.
Right, 8 seconds, Jersey Lily, starting now.
The interesting...
And Paul, yes.
Well, deviation. He said he didn't want the subject, and then he challenged me. That's surely very devious.
No, it isn't, because in just a minute, you may not want the subject, but you have to keep going on it if you want to play the game, and Clement obviously likes to play the game. 7 seconds, Jersey Lily, Clement, starting now.
One of the interesting things about Jersey Lily was she used to be paid 60% of the total box office take. She was that...
So, Clement Freud gained the extra point, speaking as the whistle went, and others in the round. He has increased his lead. Paul Merton, your turn to begin. The subject, keeping mum. Will you tell us something about that subject in this game, starting now?
Nicholas Parsons once told me that he liked to dress up in leather, wander around Piccadilly Circus, shouting at the top of his voice, "Who wants to be naughty with a pensioner?" Now... He told me this in strict secrecy, and I said, well, of course I will keep mum.
Julian Clary, challenge.
Well, I felt sorry for you. That's very deviant, isn't it?
It is very, very devious, yeah. Yes. And it's certainly incorrect, so it must be deviant. 45 seconds.
It brings a smile to your face when you start thinking about it, though, doesn't it?
Have you got the leather gear with you here in Jersey? We'll go out later if you like.
Julian, 45 seconds with you, keeping mum, starting now.
I keep my mum in a home for the bewildered. Twice a week, I have a cleaner come round, and her mum sleeps on the...
And the Freud challenge.
Hesitation.
Clement, a correct challenge, 23 seconds, keeping mum, starting now.
I would recommend that you go to a tax haven like Jersey or Guernsey, Panama, the Cayman Islands, and set up a veritable trust fund, redeemable and full of interest, so that your mother will be paid regular sums of money on quarter days, which are, as you probably know, June the 24th.
Well, Clement Freud has now increased his lead, and Julian Cleary, Damien Nimmo and Paul Merton are almost equal in second place. Derek Nimmo, Adonis is the subject. Will you tell us something about it in just a minute, starting now?
Adonis was the beloved of Aphrodite, who rose from the sea offshore at Paphos in Cyprus, known by the Greeks as, or rather Romans, can't believe it, as Venus. You see, it's rather nice. Think about that. And poor old fellow, he was killed by... What
Julian, challenge.
He hesitated.
Yes, and the poor Julian. I interpret that as hesitation, Julian. 43 seconds are available on Adonis, starting now.
Adonis is a gay club in Blackpool. It costs £6 to get in, although it's £5 on a Wednesday. £3.50 if you're a student. I've been to Adonis regularly, and the music there is marvellous. You can really get down to it on the floor, which is what I do. I dress in leather, and I've got...
Paul Merton challenge.
Station.
Paul, I agree with the challenge. 19 seconds available. Adonis starting now.
Nicholas Parsons is the finest Adonis that Britain's ever produced. He may be an OAP. He may be past it. He may be senile. He may be all these things. I don't care.
Clement
I mean, he may be
challenge.
Thousand
Derek
times.
Nimmo
I hope he's
not. I don't know why. I have a system of little lights in front of me which tell me who is challenged first. On that occasion, all the lights went off. But Clements, yours came on first.
Four maybes.
Oh, I know, what a pity. Right, so there we are. 9 seconds with you, Clement, on Adonis, starting now.
It was not until I heard Julian Clary's definition that it occurred to me that Adonis is an anagram of any sod, provided you...
I don't know why you're clapping that, but Clement Freud kept going till the whistle went and has increased his lead even further. But Paul Merton, Derek Nimmo and Julian Cleary are definitely equal in second place, but only a few points behind. Julian, your turn to begin. The subject, genius.
Genius is anyone who has attained a certain level of excellence in their chosen field. Gazza, for example, is a genius at football. In the bedroom department, I think rumbelows are the genius that we must look to. It's very difficult to say. There are certain tests that you can take to establish whether or not you are a genius. But who sets these papers? That's what I want to know. No one can tell me. I've inquired. I've been onto directory inquiries saying I want to know how to become a genius. I said, well, I can't help you. Have you tried Yellow Pages? Well, I looked it up under G, genius, G string, Guernsey, Gertie. She might be able to help you.
Paul Merton challenge.
Repetition of Guernsey.
14 seconds with you, Paul, on genius starting now.
I think it's very much an overused word. You hear about some disc jockey who is described as a genius because he manages to talk for 30 seconds between playing records. And I think the actual term genius could be applied...
Derek Nimmo challenge.
Repetition of think.
Yes, I think...
Oh, was it?
Yes, quite a tough challenge, but it's a correct one. Derek, you've got him with 1 second to go on genius starting now.
Oscar Wilde was for me...
Clement Freud's still in the lead. Derek Nimmo has moved 1 point ahead of Julian Cleary and Paul Merton, who equal in third place. And the next round is to be the last round, because we're running out of time, which is sad. Is that sad? You don't sound as if you care less, actually.
Quite a few Maybe. People don't find it sad at all.
Oh, well, they should have paid.
It'd be even sadder.
Clement Freud, will you take the next round? Teams, 60 seconds as usual, starting now.
If you come from the West Country or went to school there, as did I, teams instantly bring up Plymouth Argyle, Torquay United, Exeter City, and as you leave London to go in the westerly direction in which my education was purchased by my parents.
Julian Clary Charles.
Deviation, we don't want to know about his education.
So you think his education is deviating from the subject of teams?
I do.
Right. All right. It's the last round. There are 40 seconds left. We want to hear from you. Teams is a subject starting now.
Teams is a gay club in Brighton. I've been there on many occasions. In fact, I've got a season ticket. And I like this club particularly because it's got...
Derek Challenge.
We didn't repeat club, unfortunately, but I want to know when Nicholas Parsons was with you.
He was driving the coach.
I have to make a living somehow on what they pay me at least. Derek, you have a correct challenge. You have 26 seconds. Teams, starting now.
Teams is a club in Hobart in Tasmania, otherwise known as Van Diemen's Land, where all the footballers, and they play Australian rules, foregather. A great multitude of real men who are sitting there with these funny balls which they use for this game. It is actually, if you've been to a Launceston, you will find there is a branch of the same establishment that's opened there quite recently.
Well, as I said before, that was to be the last round. We have no more time, so let me tell you what the final point situation was. All contributing admirably. Paul Merton and Julian Clary were equal in third place, but they were only 3 points behind Derek Nimmo, and he was 3 points behind our leader, Clement Freud. So we say this week, Clement Freud is the winner. I know some listeners are more interested in the points than the contribution. Most of us love the contribution, and we've had magnificent contribution this week from Paul Merton, Julian Clary, Clement Freud, and Derek Nimmo. We thank them deeply. We also thank Elaine Wigley, who's been keeping the score. She's also been keeping the stopwatch going for me. Also, Ian Messiter, who created the game. Many thanks to you, Ian, and Jobson, who organises and produces the show. From all of them, and from me, Nicholas Parsons, thank you for tuning in. Thank our audience here in Jersey for attending. We've enjoyed the whole experience. We hope you will tune again, listeners, the next time we take to the air and we play Just a Minute. Till then, from all of us, goodbye.